The podcast on Haunted Hill will contain spoilers and swearing.
I am the devil, and I am here to do the devil's work.
Hey, so this might come. Be one of us.
I didn't tell you my name.
Hang up.
I didn't tell them my name.
It is time to keep your appointment.
Hello and welcome to the podcast on Haunted Hill, episode 118.
Say what?
Say what? This is our sexy, 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 sexy Valentine's special.
Oh, yeah, baby.
I could have gone Barry White, but I went old sort of drunken perv. My name's Gav.
And I'm Dan. Dan the Bone.
Dan the Bone. I'm Gav the Whore.
That doesn't work.
No. Yes, welcome, listeners. If it's your first time, Dan and I like to discuss a couple of films each episode in depth, and we just like to then just talk general shit with each other, don't we, Dan?
We do. We love a little catch-up and a silly nonsense talk. And we've done this now. This is probably our seventh or eighth in a row annual Valentine's episode. We always try and pick a couple of sexy horror films, romantic horror films, or something.
Sorry, keeping that vein, yeah.
Yeah, you know, no porn. We haven't done porn yet. You know, we're not ruling it out.
We could always do like the Blair Witch parody.
The Whore Witch Project.
No, it's the Bear Ass. I don't know.
Shaving Ryan's privates.
I don't know, but we could always do something like that because it would be quite comical to just sort of almost go for it. At this point, she gets her boobs out again. It might be comical,
and
it might not.
Another cum shot.
Yeah, no, because it's softcore. Softcore's not going to have any cum shots.
Is it soft, is it?
Yeah. A lot of these parodies. Well, no, actually, I suppose. That was the Blair Witch one, was a softcore parody. Anyway, don't know how we've got onto parodies of horror movies in porn world, but Dan.
Edward Dildo Hands.
Dan, are you hello? Loved up? Are you loved up? Are you?
I'm loved up. I love you, Gav.
Oh, I love you too.
So, as a man to a man, I love you.
Thanks.
I think it's for people to tell each other they love her. And listeners, we love you.
We do. And welcome with us. Welcome with us. Come with us. And you're welcome into the Dan and I's mind of loveliness. Sweet things.
Fucking hell. So let's talk about the films that we're covering for episode 118, and then we can have a catch up and see, we'll talk about what we've been watching. So we figured, you know, what does everyone do on Valentine's Day? If you're single, you try and get a date. So we've got a couple of films, a couple of movies that we're going to talk about tonight.
Yeah,
our two main reviews are to do with dating,
both on dates. Yeah.
So we're going to cover the absolutely classic cult film, which I can't believe we haven't got around to covering yet, Night of the Creeps.
Yep.
Classic 80s Tom Atkins moustache, and obviously that involves a prom night dates, all that kind of stuff. So there's your link there, tenuous as it may be. And we're covering, and it's not often we do this, but Gav suggested a film which I'd never seen. So this is my first watch of a film, a British comedy, I think it's 2017, horror comedy called Double Date.
Every once in a while, Britain does kind of bring out a comedy horror movie which is pretty good. Every once in a while, yeah, you do get one which is like, that's a pretty decent movie, like, both in terms of comedy and horror, you know.
Comedy. Yeah, I mean, some of the classics, you know, Shaun of the Dead, Dog Soldiers, you know, we have been very lucky, but when they do come out, whew, we do comedy horror quite well, I think, because we're a cynical bunch here, aren't we, the UK?
Yeah,
quite
cynical. But yeah, so Double Date, I'm glad you enjoyed it. As far as I imagine, I think you did enjoy it. Yeah, I'm glad you watched it, because yeah, I watched it the first time last year, and I was just like, oh, that's super good. And I was like, dude, I'll message you straight away, we've got to cover this. You know, like, okay, we can do it Valentine's Day. So I persuaded you, and obviously it's you going in blind, so I could have been talking absolute nonsense. But
a blind date almost, Gav.
Indeed, with Cilla Black. People might not know who that is. Any listeners outside of England?
Now, Gav, we need to talk about what we've been watching. So we'll get to those movies later on. As always, the time machine's revved up. We're going to go back to 2018. Not far back at all, really, now. And Bill Murray has arrived.
Yeah.
Bill Murray's fixing himself a couple of drinks. He's ready to introduce us into World of the Strange later.
He's not going to be pulling out his little snakey later. That was terrible. Yeah,
you know what he's like. You know what he's like.
Disgusting.
But we've both watched two brand new films recently. You've watched one of them when it first came out, and you've watched the other one. So these are brand new entries into very big horror franchises. So let's get it out of the way. Let's have the conversation, but we'll keep it spoiler free because they're so new.
Yeah, they are both two movies which have just taken over the internet. Like, Texas Chainsaw Massacre literally is fucking everywhere, isn't it, at the moment? Literally every
Let's talk about Halloween Kills first.
Go for it.
That came out first. So you watched that at the cinema, didn't you? Oh, no, you didn't watch it at the cinema. You rented it on the day it came out. I'd rented it from Amazon Prime the other day. Mm-hmm. Finally got around to it.
Yeah.
So sat there, I watched it. Do you want to go first? What were your thoughts on it? Because you touched on this when you did watch it a few months ago.
I don't know.
Just remind us what you thought of it.
I didn't come out in very positively, and I don't know why. Like, I don't know. If you look at it just as like a standalone horror movie, back in the day, if I was a kid, just put it on like a Halloween movie, I'd be like, fuck me, that's fucking brutal. There's loads of kills in it. I'd have been quite happy. Nowadays, I don't know. I just wasn't. I was a bit like, yeah, whatever, another Michael Myers movie. I don't know why. I wish it'd been a bit more Jamie Lee Curtis. I don't know. I just wasn't. It was all right. There was a couple of little bits in it. There's a couple of little scenes here and there I quite digged, actually. I like the two gay guys in the house.
Yeah, I like those. Big John and Little John. They were some of my favourite characters.
See, I like that scene. There's a couple of little bits here and there, but overall, the whole movie, I will probably watch it again because I always have done the Halloween movies. You know, me and Michael, we go back. We're buddies, you know.
He
kept me. I used to think that little girl was like my sister, didn't I? Held her.
Yeah, Danielle Harris.
Got drunk, sent her an email.
God.
Got a restraining order taken out of me. From over the pond. So I've always been Halloween. I've always been in the Halloween side. If it's like what do you choose? Of later years, I've kind of been like, Nightmare on Elm Street can kind of fuck off a bit, to be honest. I've kind of been like, whatever. Freddy's, whatever. I've been all really in the side of Jason. Not that there's really been any new Jason films, funny enough.
I wonder, right?
I wonder if there will be now, though.
That leads me nicely into my thoughts, if I may.
I will watch it again. It wasn't as satisfying. It was just kind of what I imagined. I'd be like, I don't know if it's because everyone's just hyped up. So I'm like, it's amazing. So like, but then again, it should be my own opinion. So I don't know. I didn't come at it like I did with the other one we're going to speak of. I actually came out going, oh. So you go first with Halloween.
I wonder if the delay hurt it a bit, because we had to wait an extra year for it, and I think people got hyped up so much about it that when it got delivered, it was obviously quite disappointing for a lot of people.
Yeah, they did jump on making it straight away, though, which is quite a rush to make. Then obviously they had it sitting around for a little while. I don't know, because I kind of think that gap between, I actually might have got a little bored of waiting, or I forgot about it, or I don't know.
Well, my thoughts on it are, it didn't feel like a Halloween movie.
More story in that first one, though. The one we saw in the cinema, that felt like a real good cohesive story. Like, there's some planned stuff in it, what's going on.
The story and the characters were the biggest problem for me. It was a mess. I didn't get... What was that whole bit in the bar where they stood up and they just told their story?
The random character. Why is the nurse there? Who was just driving Loomis that evening? Why is she just there all of a sudden with these other ones?
It was like a fan film where they've gone like, what would happen if all the characters knew each other? The characters that had appeared for a split second here and there.
Halloween world.
I didn't get I didn't get, I think I got what they were trying to do, but the writers could do so much better than that, as proven in the first, in 2018 Halloween, which I've got problems with, but I enjoyed overall.
Yeah.
I just didn't, I thought they all made stupid decisions. I thought none of them acted like their characters did in Halloween 2018. I thought, I don't know what Jamie Lee Curtis was playing at, like what Laurie was playing at. Her character just wasn't acting the same.
Much her, in it.
Her daughter and granddaughter were acting completely differently.
Yeah,
you know, I liked some of the, but I liked some of the flashback stuff. Do you think with the guy from Jim Cummings was in it? I didn't realize he was in it. You know, your mate that you hate the face of from.
Do you think they are, because they've obviously gone like, that's it, we're going to do a trilogy, then next year that's it, the last of it, if that's what they're actually going to do. You never actually think these killers are ever going to go. You always feel like there's going to be another Jason or Freddy, because it's just been with us since we were kids. But do you think that they are, because they're going to do that third one, go, that's it, they've kind of just, the second one's a rush to get loads of shit out there. Push, then the next one will be more story-driven.
I think so. So we talked about Jason just now, and I said that's interesting you say that. So I would have enjoyed this more if you take Michael out of it and it was Jason. And the reason I say that is because there were some more supernatural elements towards the end, which I'd never really liked that whole cult thing about Michael. I feel like if this was Jason, it would explain why he was a bit more unstoppable. And I can imagine a cult of people, not a cult, like a lynch mob of people hunting him down like they did to Michael in this. I don't know, it just would have worked better for me if it was Jason. I kept thinking all the way through, I wish this was Jason, I wish this was Jason, I wish this was Jason.
Yeah, I think that.
It just didn't feel like a Michael movie at all. And I don't know, there was so much in it that I just didn't agree with and didn't like. It was really violent. That was great.
Yeah, but that's what goes more of you thinking of Jason. Jason films are real violent, and that's one of the reasons we like that. With Halloween's, we kind of, I don't know, I think it's because it helms from John Carpenter. It helms from, like, this classic fucking film. Jason, Friday the 13th isn't as classic as that. It is, but it isn't at the same time. This is John Carpenter we talk about. This is groundbreaking, like the Steadicam stuff. I know it's done before, but it influenced Scream, which has influenced other films. So it's a big movie to continue.
I found myself enjoying and hating some things of it at the same time. I enjoyed the fireman scene because I wish that was Keanu Reeves in the John Wick movie, and it was Michael Myers, and then when the scene was over, I was like, hang on a minute, Michael, there was like 10 or 12 really strong, well-trained firemen, they couldn't take down this one guy.
It made him action hero, which is, or not, or anti-hero, which was really weird. So yeah, Jason would have sit better in that world, actually.
Yeah, so that's my thoughts on it. I ended up giving it, I think I gave it 3 out of 10.
Oh, I probably would have given it like maybe 4 out of 10, but yeah, I don't know. I will watch it again, however, maybe, you know. Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Weird.
Texas Chainsaw.
Now,
I preferred that to Halloween Kills.
Oh, fuck yeah. It's weird, though, because the studio who made it, as far as I know, if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. Studio that made it screen tested it, and it tested real bad, so they sold it to Netflix. And Netflix are going to get what they want, because they want people to sit and watch it. If there's a new Texas Chainsaw Massacre on Netflix, everyone's just going to watch it. So they get what they want anyway, because we've all got a subscription. We don't have to pay for it. It all comes out at the same time. Everybody universally can start chatting about it and hashtagging it. And it works in the world that we live in now, because that's what we all want. We all want that right now, in a month's time, it'll be forgotten about. And I was the same as, I think, some people, thinking, oh, God, what are we going to get here? And then I heard some people saying, oh, fucking woke people in it. And I was like, okay, so it's going to be really full-on, really, really annoying characters. So start watching it straight away from the get-go. I was like, it's a really good cinematography. Why is this shot so beautifully? And there's a nice bit of grain on it as well. And I checked out the camera they used, an Airy Mini. Aeroflex Mini. So they obviously put the grain on themselves. It wasn't shot on film. But I was like, this looks aesthetically really, really nice. I'm really like it. And then the characters came up and I was like, they're not as annoying as I thought they could be. I thought they could be really, really in your face. Like, hashtag, Twitter. Stuff like that. And it wasn't at all. It was actually dialed back close. The only time I had a slight problem with it was when everybody starts live streaming on Instagram. Texas Leatherface. And it's a bit like, that's a bit of shit. Apart from that, I liked it. I like it. It's a little town with a few people. I really like the garage dude in it. I wanted him to be in it more. I was thinking I was going to hate the garage guy. I really liked him, you know?
Yeah.
What do you think?
So I ended up enjoying it more than I thought I would and more than it probably deserved. It's definitely flawed. I actually didn't like the main characters. I really hated the majority of them. But then that's what you watch these movies for, because you know they're all going to get killed at some point anyway.
Yeah.
I didn't like the two main girls, the sisters. I thought they were really incredibly annoying. But that's fine. I liked the story was so different, because initially I was watching it with a friend of Alice's, who he's really into horror films as well. He hadn't seen it, so we watched it together.
What was he thinking when he went in? Did you both pre?
We both knew it was. We were going into a terrible film, potentially.
Yeah.
So we watched it with a Chinese takeaway, you know, and a drink. But we picked it apart as it was, you know, unfolding. And I was like, why would they do that? Why would you go there? Like you do. But then I was thinking, well, actually, like, I've never seen a movie where there's a ghost town that some young kids are buying in part of an auction.
An odd one, but it's ridiculous fine.
That Leatherface has lived in an orphanage all these years and never been caught. But the gore was great. The violence was really good, like better than Halloween Kills.
There was a little bit of
that
suspense.
First kill with the guy's arm and everything. I won't spoil it, but like that was amazing.
Oh yeah,
there was suspense. That
made me go, I love suspense. I kind of the third act once he stepped on the bus, it went slightly not. I wanted the bus to drive away. The woman go no, and the bus drives away. Then there's only like two or three of them in the town, and he stalks them. I wanted that more suspense. But all right, he took out a whole bus.
To be
that was
fair,
kind of fun.
Well, to be fair though, it's called the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. This is the first proper massacre I've ever seen Leatherface do.
I did enjoy that. Again, though, here we go. This is another film, though. Texas Chainsaw Massacre original. We did the commentary on it. That film is fucking incredible. When you look at it now, like, it's one of the film gods movies, because, like, you didn't know what you were making, did you? Because this is really good.
And funny that both Halloween and Texas, you know, they came out 4 years apart, 74 and 78, or 77. What was Halloween, 77? Three or 4 years apart. Very low budget, didn't know what they were making. And all these years later, in 2022, we're sat here talking about another entry in the franchise.
Of
you know,
both of them. And
the
12th
Halloween film.
I know.
Funny
enough, I had to do a bit of a drive today, and I had a Storm Franklin helped push me down the country. You love old Franklin in his wheelchair.
I fucking hate Franklin.
You wait till your next birthday.
I hate that
Sally,
guy.
Sally!
Don't.
Anyway.
Him and the fat one from that one Friday the 13th movie.
What do you rate Texas Chainsaw Massacre?
So 2022, I ended up giving it 4.5. I would watch it again with beer and friends, and I didn't see where the story was going at times, although I felt like I was predicting it, and it just took me by surprise, really. It was fun. The ending was really, really, really good. The final shot, like before the credits. There was obviously an after credit scene. If you haven't watched it, guys, stick around for the after credit scene.
Yeah, with the automatic
but the
car.
Ending,
yeah,
that was like, whoa. It got a bit much, like the fight scenes were a bit much. And it was
a little bit.
We talked about this. There's a Jamie Lee Curtis style character in it.
What the fuck? She looks exactly like
Jamie
Lee. I thought
they were copying.
They must have been. They obviously they went into production with this because of how well Halloween did. obviously.
Yeah.
But,
you know,
what's
going to be next? Are we
going to
get all
worse?
The final girls coming back?
Did you see some of those shots though, in the field? They were beautiful shots, gorgeous shots.
Absolutely.
Like when she turns up in the field and with the lights and she's standing there looking around, it's like, man, that's really nice.
There was a really great moment where one of the girls goes back into the orphanage, and as she steps into the steps, there's a puddle of blood on the floor, and you see her reflection in the puddle of blood, but it's on a slight angle as well, and as she walks in, and I just thought that would make an amazing poster.
Yeah, quite a few shots would make real nice pictures.
It looked beautiful, I got to be honest. Halloween looked terrible.
They didn't need to make Texas Chainsaw Massacre like that. There's no reason to do that, but they did that because the first one has got the odd shot here and there, but nothing like that. So, yeah, I was really impressed by that. But I would give it a 5 out of 10.
It's definitely better than a lot. It's better than any of the Texas Chainsaws I've seen since probably the one that came out, the first remake that came out.
Yeah, yeah, that was a good one with Jessica Biel.
Yeah, that was really good, that one, I must say, for a remake. Everything since then has been god-awful.
It's a shame because I really liked Thingamajiggy as the sheriff in some of those Texas Chainsaw Massacre movies. The Sarge, the guy who Sarge. Hey, you guys! Full Metal Jacket and stuff. I can't remember his name.
Yeah.
Texas Chainsaw Massacre films. You know. Anyway, yeah, that was cool. Last night I did go to cinema. Sarah and I did go to cinema, and we watched Death on the Nile. My murder mysteries. Not as good as I've seen the original. I know the story. Not as good as the Orient Express, the recent one that came out, but it was all right. I did apologise to Sarah afterwards because she nicely came with me, because it's not really her thing, and it was about an hour. The first hour was not really character development, but just these things going on. It got a bit of a while before the murder happens, and it's been like, you could have made this a bit quicker.
Yeah.
It was alright. I quite liked it because I like murder mysteries. So I have the patience to sit there knowing that. I've watched loads of like old British ones where like you hardly even get a murder. It's just all for blah, 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 blah. So I was fine with it, but I did look at Sarah a couple of times, think, oh, I'm going to apologise when we get out because that's not really her thing. At least when there's a few bodies, I was like, oh, okay, at least there's a few bodies now. She might like that. And there's a bit of blood splatter, so she'd be a bit happier. It's alright. What have you been watching?
I watched a film that everyone's been telling me to watch. Not really horror, but it's very violent and bloody. A film called Nobody. I finally got around to watching that.
Oh, yeah.
I think you've seen it.
I saw the cinema. I really like that.
I thought it was really good. In fact, it's not often I'll rewind a fight scene or an action scene, but I definitely rewind that bit on the bus. Where
unexpected,
first,
wasn't it?
You just think, what the fuck is going on here? And I actually... I bought it on Prime, so I owned a digital copy of it, and
wicked.
I will be watching it again and again. I thought it was really, really good.
Yeah, I need to get a copy. Yeah.
I also watched one movie which is my first time as a parent watching a film about child trauma that threw me a little bit.
It's not good, is it? It's hard. It's really hard, but when you become a parent, to watch child stuff, that's what I keep away from most of the time.
I watched Killing of a Sacred Deer with Colin Farrell and Nicole Kidman. The ending of that made me very sort of like, wow, okay. Really like sat with me for days. So I really highly rated it. And I thought I really recommend watching it, but just go into it knowing that the ending will mess you up for a day or two afterwards. But it's really, really good film.
I don't want to watch it.
Really tense, really good film. The only other one I've watched, really, is a very old film. Can't believe I've never seen it. And you've probably seen it, or at least seen the posters for it. It's from the 80s. It's called 976 Evil.
Oh, I saw it once many years ago.
Really enjoyed it.
Yeah.
You ring a number and the devil will grant your wishes and you slowly start morphing into a demon. But it's done in a very 80s kind of Fright Night type way. Absolutely had a blast with it. That's what I've been watching.
Fair enough. I've watched other stuff, but those ones are good to talk about, I think. It's good to talk about Texas Chainsaw Massacre. But yeah, it is a bit popular. The old, have you seen that? How many people posting about that film?
Yeah.
My whole feed's like, wow. What the fuck?
That's why I had to watch it as well, because I knew that you'd seen it. I knew we were recording, and I thought I'll probably push that one up to the top of the list just because it's on Netflix. It's only an hour and 20 minutes.
It's
perfect, like Alice makes over.
Yeah, that's it. I'm going to do it again, to be honest. Not right now, in the future. It's one of those things that you see people sort of go, 0 out of 10, absolute garbage, worst acting I've ever seen. Yeah, so I'm not even going to bother. I don't even get into any discussion with anybody. I don't even do it. Likes, comments, no, nothing. Because, like, what's the point of talking to you? I don't know who you are. You're obviously a buffoon, because I could give you many, many films where we've got fucking awful acting that had okay acting. Like, you can't not say that. There's no way you can say that. You're just doing that to get a reaction. So I'm like, I'm not even going to go there with it. I'm not one of you young whippersnappers with you. Well, I'm going to get a reaction with a hashtag. I'm not, whatever. Too old for this.
The only other movie I wanted to mention was related to our last episode, where we covered a couple of those British saucy comedy horrors. That one's for you, Sarah. I watched Alice's mum stayed over a couple of days ago.
Mum?
No, she wanted to come and stay over, right, because one of our babies was not very well, and she felt sorry for her, so she said, I'll come over, and we're fine.
I could edit all of this, couldn't I, to make you say anything I want about this situation.
You could indeed. But I said to her, I'll tell you what we'll do, we'll watch a Carry On movie tonight. And she said, okay then. So I put on Carry On Again, Doctor.
That's amazing. Why did you? Has she ever shown any interest in a Carry On film? But did you go, it's old school British humour, she might like it?
Well, we were talking about the Carry On films because I told her me and you had just recorded our episode and, you know, da da da. And she made me do all the impressions. And then she said, I said, oh, Alice has got BritBox, which is a subscription service with, like, it's got everything British film-wise, like Hammer Horror, Carry On, James Bond, they're all on there. So I said, oh, well, look, let's get one of them up. So I picked Carry On Again, Doctor. And there was, we got about 2 minutes into it, and she said, oh, this is too much, I'm going to have to go to bed. She left the room.
Too much? What, as in, like, too risque?
Well, there was, what was his name? Dr. I can't even remember their names now, but the names alone were like double entendres. There was one guy that walked in and he was limping, and these two doctors said, oh, let's, what do you reckon's wrong with him? And one of them said, I reckon it's a slip disc. And the other one said, I think it's hemorrhoids. So they went up to him and they said, excuse me, sir, we've got a bet.
I saw this when I was trying to find stuff for our last show. I just watched this clip on YouTube gone.
Did you?
Yeah, I almost put it in the show. Yeah.
I've bet my colleague that you've got hemorrhoids, and he's bet that you've got a slip disc. And he says, oh, so you thought hemorrhoids, you were wrong. You thought a slip disc, you were wrong. I thought I was going to break wind, and looks like I was wrong too. And he's basically shat himself, and he's walking along. And then they wheel Barbara Windsor in the smallest bikini I've ever seen. That was about the time that Alice's mum was like, I'm done with this. Because he was slapping her on the bum. There was boobs flying all over the place.
Oh, God.
It was cheeky.
Listeners outside of England, please check out your Carry On films and go, what on earth? Yeah, anyway.
How do they get away with it?
Do you want to get on with the show?
Yeah, let's go and do a little bit of Night of the Creeps, I think.
Yeah.
Bit of the old classic 80s.
I wondered if Tom Atkins' moustache was actually one of those slugs.
I was thinking that at the time, because they're firing out all over the place.
Yeah.
No one can... Who's got a better moustache?
Tom Atkins.
Tom Atkins.
Tom Selleck.
Tom Selleck.
Tom Selleck. Or, I'm...
Hang on. There's one other guy. Chuck Norris. Who would win in a fight out of those three moustaches?
Who would win in a fight? Well, you're going to have Chuck Norris is going to win in a fight.
Yeah, but his moustache on its own, would it? I don't think anything can beat Tom Atkins' moustache. I think it's too
big. Oh, come on, look at Tom Selleck's moustache. That is good.
Yeah, but
back in the day,
it's beautiful, it's glossy.
Back in the day, I would have been Tom Atkins, but nowadays I'm still watching my Magnum. I'm currently in an episode at the moment.
You still got your man crush on Tom Selleck.
Tom Selleck, so I'm going to go camp Tom Selleck at the moment.
Yeah, sorry. I tell you what, I'd camp all over Tom Selleck as well. So,
bet you would.
Let's leave it there. Well, let's have a trailer for Night of the Creeps. We'll be back to discuss this cult classic in a moment.
Indeed. See you soon.
The night of the fall is finally here for Chris, Cindy, and JC. It's going to be the best night of their lives. But tonight is also the night of the creeps. From a world unknown comes a nightmare unimagined. First, they are under you, around you, on you, and then inside you.
They get in through your mouth and you walk around while they incubate, even if you're dead.
They are a new breed of terror. They are a different kind of horror.
Zombies, exploding heads, creepy crawlies.
We could have a little problem.
The creeps are taking over.
I got good news and bad news, girls.
What?
The good news is your dates are here.
What's the bad news?
They're dead.
You have never had a night like this. Night of the Creeps. If you scream, you're dead.
Okay, so first up for our sexy love fest is Night. Thanks, Gav. Sexy. Is Night of the Creeps.
Sexy.
Talking of creeps, Gav sounds like a creep. Night of the Creeps from 1986, rated R.
Night of the Weinsteins.
Oh dear. So it's a bit of a lame synopsis here, but it goes as this: alien brain parasites entering humans through the mouth turn their hosts into a killing zombie, and some teenagers start to fight back against them.
not the smoothest of flowing sentences.
Yeah, it's not really doing it for me, but. You know, when I heard about this film, I'll go first if I may. I heard about this film because I never saw it in the 80s. I probably didn't see this film until coming on the late 90s, I'd say. And I'd heard about this movie that was, if you like zombies and you like aliens and cheese, you know, and sort of Return of the Living Dead, that kind of style comedy, a bit of Evil Dead style comedy all thrown in together. You'd love this, Dan. So I ended up watching it, and I wasn't blown away the first time I saw it. I felt that for such a short film it trundled along a bit slowly, but I've probably seen this film about 30 times over the years, and every time I watch it, I get a little bit more of an appreciation for it. And I do, it's like a comfort blanket now. I don't put it up there with the Burbs or Ghostbusters or something, but it's definitely one that whenever it's on the horror channel over here in the UK, I'll set it to record. Or if it just happens to be on, I'll turn over and I'll watch an hour of it, half an hour of it, because it's just fun, silly, comforting cinema. And it is a cult movie. There's a lot of... It's not film god's movie, but there's definitely a lot of elements in it that are so weird and wonderful and unique that this is why I think it's become a cult movie. It's directed by Fred Decker, who did The Monster Squad, as we know, and was involved in writing things like The Predator, Robocop, and a few other classic cult movies as well. It's got some ties to The Monster Squad, some little Easter eggs here and there as well. I think the two main characters are really interesting. There's a real bromance between them. They even say, and this ties into our episode, at one point, one of them even says to the other, "Hey man, I love you." And like in the 80s, that was like the 80s where the FAG word was thrown around all over the place. They just say, "I love you, man," like in this movie, like that, like it's nothing. And I really respect that. I think that's great. And finally, before I let you speak, I also love that every single character in it is named after someone from the horror world, the community, you know, whether you're Sergeant Cronenberg or any of these people like Craven and all that kind of stuff. They're all directors and actors from the horror world. Everyone's named after it. So it's a real, like, nerdy film in that respect as well. You can tell it's made with love. So you tell me about when you watched it and what you think of it, and then we'll get into that.
I would have watched it with John, if he's ever listening in the future. He might well do.
Hiya, John.
Sorry, he had really bad COVID.
Not today,
he's better now, yeah.
Send them love.
And it was one of those films you could smoke a joint with your mates of an afternoon. When you're, it's you kind of, when you're not really, you're sort of maybe just sort of student, just out of student getting into full-time work, you're still not really taking it all that seriously. It's that movie, yeah. You sit and watch it. Now, I think that's sort of around the time I watched it, and I was just like, oh man, this is like just a real fun movie, and we really got on board with it. But this was before you had groups on Facebook and stuff where you could actually know anybody else liked horror movies. It was amazing when you found someone liked horror movies. Oh, you like horror movies? Oh, wow! You think you're like this rare breed of people.
Yeah.
But we found out over it. You know, we're definitely into the team, not the groups. Looking at it now, you know, because Fred Dekker, absolute. We're along with Shane Black writing The Monster Squad. Both of those two films. Sure, Shane Black's the one that wrote Predator. Did Fred Dekker have some writing credits on that then?
Yeah, he's got some writing credits on Predator and The Predator and some of the other
cool
stuff as
wicked,
well.
Wicked. Oh, yeah, because I know Black in that last one that came out. That's right, you do. Yes, Fred and Dekker. Fred Dekker. With both those films, it's absolute passion. It's heart on your sleeve. Both these films, this film and that film, it's absolute, I love horror. I want to make this movie. Monster Squad has all the different creatures. This one has zombies, slasher, aliens, parasites. You got four different bits of horror.
It's like
there.
A B movie as well.
It's a horror fan mate getting this chance to make the movie that they want to make. If you had a chance when you were a kid, 15, or if I was, and we wanted to make a movie, we threw everything at the wall and we're like, we don't care if it sticks, we're just going to do it. And that's what this film is. I think that is also to its detriment a little bit, though. I'd rather have liked to have seen more focus on one of those elements. It is a fun movie, absolutely. I do have issues. I think the casting's pretty shit. I don't like the two leads. I have no interest in them at all. I never saw them in another film. I don't know what films they've been in. I'm sure there are. And obviously, I don't want to be a negative person towards this film because it's got a big cult following. But I'm looking at it now as a 45-year-old in 2022. And that's how I'm looking at it now. You know, my patience is thinner with films, but I still look at this film and go, it is a great fun movie. Tom Atkins is so much fun. I still love, I love the bit when he has that discussion and he basically admits to murdering someone. And yep. When he says to the guy, what do you think happened next? And he's like, should you tell me this? And he just carries on ignoring.
He says,
the response because he doesn't care. Whatever he was going to say, close. He was going to say close. He doesn't care. And I like that play.
Yeah.
Always did do. But yeah, I wish it'd been more. I wish the two main leads had been changed, miscast to something else. Or not miscast. I think they were miscast. Recast. And I would like more focus on one of them. But obviously, the aliens bring the parasites down. The parasites go into the people to make the people be the zombies. Then there's a slasher, an axe killer in it. But I don't know. I don't know. They all didn't seem to be in it enough, or it didn't. Do you know what I mean? It was very. Then at one point, all of a sudden, there's like they've got a flamethrower, but they just give it to the girl that's there. Why has Tom Atkins not got the flamethrower? You want Tom Atkins to be standing there on the field, flame throwing zombies, and you'd be like, that is the most amazing thing I've ever seen. And he's not, he's inside with a little gun, a little like 22 or something. Like, what's going on here? You've missed a trick. So it was apparently written in a week. I think it should have been looked at again and sort of had to, I'm sure I had rewrites. Initially, obviously, the line, the basis of it was probably a week. But I just wish that it had maybe someone else overseeing it. Not, I don't want to say it because it's a massive fan movie made by a fan. I don't want to see some corporate dickhead come in and do things, but at the same time, I almost feel like not really the corporate person, but someone that really wants to push a direct storyline. Do you know what I mean? And I think this movie could have been in the hemisphere. Like, this is one of those fucking great movies. But I think you almost then going into the realm of a Spielberg thing, and then you're, what if Spielberg directed this? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And put those elements into it, more emphasis on things, because this is very like, quick, go, 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 because it goes really quick. And it does, but it's because there's so many elements going on. So, but I do like the movie. I wanted to get that out of the way so I don't have that hanging over my head when I'm saying stuff and I don't come across as negative, because I know it has a big cult following and I don't want to piss anyone off. I love you.
See, and for me, the flaws actually are what I makes me love it every time I watch it again, a bit more and a bit more and a bit more, because it's just so unique and so out there and so weird. And I remember getting this, talking of the two main cast members, I remember getting this at some point muddled up a bit with Fright Night 2, and a little bit with Vamp as well, because they've all got like
same sort
a
of
couple
realm
of guys
of era as well.
And actually, that would be an amazing evening watching this, Fright Night 2 and Vamp.
I like other leads, though. I like Vamp 2 and
the strong leads.
Leads and those, you know.
But Tom Atkins famously says this was his favourite role, his favourite film.
And he says because he likes to work with Fred Decker. And that's because I think Fred Decker's coming at it like a fucking kid in a candy shop going, yeah, well, I can make the horror movie. You give me all this money and all this stuff to make this horror movie. Amazing! So I reckon he just had so much fun. And now I reckon he's... Because Tom Atkins came up with looking at the flowers, looking at the rose when he came in. So I reckon
I
probably said to Tom Atkins, just do whatever you want. What do you want to do with your character? Which you should do anyway, really. You should try and trust slightly in your actor to take their character and come up with quirks and things. But I reckon it was just fun to make.
Well, I think that thing at the moment where he smells the rose as he's about to look at the dead body, that was brilliant, because with the last shot, spoiler alert, but after Tom Atkins is killed at the end, they sort of focus on a rose at the end as a little memorial to his character.
Oh, nice.
But also, I paid homage to him as when I acted in your movie, Shadow of Death, at one point, but
as
not
Craven.
So much smelling the rose as Officer Super Special Officer Craven. I remember
ten years this year.
I know, that's crazy, isn't it? I remember the moment where Tom Atkins smelt the rose, but I wanted to do something slightly different, so I just got stuck in all those rose thorns. Do you remember, in that bush?
Yeah.
And then I just said, "You fucking prick," to the roses rather than smell them. But that was like my weird tribute to Tom Atkins and that. So even that sort of, you know, influenced me. But yeah, it's a cult movie, like you said. And I don't think, you know, I think everybody will know that this movie's got flaws. It's got practical effects, though, which we're big fans of. Mm-hmm. Really, some really good practical effects and some really weird practical effects and some really funny, quirky moments. Shall we jump into it?
Absolutely. And by the way, my little village hall here, I'm going to find out how much it is to hire it out, and I'll do a screening of Shadow of Death. And just get everyone to come along. Anyone who wants to come along.
Amazing.
Yeah. Just be free.
Amazing.
Just come down, you know. I've got a projector and stuff.
Get some tins of beer and
just, in my little village hall. My little village. Out in the sticks. Right.
Shadow of Death.
I know.
So, we get the titles, we get the score. It's all very sci-fi, 50s.
Comic-like.
Yeah,
like the text, the font.
Creep show type of thing.
Yeah.
And we kick things off, as I love to see with any movie, with weird little naked aliens running around.
They look like almost cute testicles mashed together.
They're very strange. Alice caught the beginning of this and she said, "What the fuck is this?"
Hang on, isn't this her catchphrase around your house?
Yeah, I said to her, I'd forgotten about this bit. I don't know why, I always forget about the weird naked aliens at the beginning. It's like the Predator. I always forget that you see the spaceship at the very start of Predator. I don't know why I always forget that. It's weird.
Yeah.
But weird little naked aliens running around. And one of them manages to escape. And he's got the slugs, there's death slugs, there's zombie slugs with him.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah, he's bringing it to space, isn't he? That is the that is what's going to set off this catastrophe of slug mouth in sucking things.
Well, then Alice got very confused because then it went black and white.
Yeah, 1959 prom.
1959, sorority row, the students, all nice and black. She said, "Oh, this is really well shot. Was this made in the 50s then?" And I said,
"Yeah, sets are lovely, aren't they? It looks really authentic." I was actually quite impressed with this. I guess a studio lot, you know, and they probably had cars there. But yeah, it looked really good.
You've got all the students pulled up the spot where they all like to sort of kiss, you know, under the moonlight. You know what it was like back in the 50s? All sort of fingering and blowjobs in the cars. Probably not any of that, just kissing.
It's probably not blowjobs. It's going to be fingering and handjobs, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, there's an APB on the radio about an escaped lunatic, Gav. An escaped lunatic is on the loose.
It's that classic one on the radio, is escaped lunatic. But then again, this was quite an old film, so at the time, yeah. I've always liked
police
that.
Police are reminding you to stay indoors.
It's like the Tales from the Crypt Christmas one, though, isn't it? Escaped lunatic is gone. Oh! It's the Father Christmas. Yeah. It's fun. I like this bit.
Well, our main two, our lovers, they see a shooting star.
Which is not a shooting star.
And I love this. Well, it's not. No, it's the spaceship. But I love this moment now because this is like really... I've never seen this before at this point where the cop appears to sort of say, "Oh, you guys need to get inside." And then it turns out it's a young Tom Atkins. And that's actually his girlfriend in the car with some other guy. And he's like...
Yeah.
Just get yourself home. And he still sort of tells her to sort of get home, but he's caught her red-handed.
I don't know. I would have been quite happy going with the movie of Tom Atkins now as the cop, but just the axe killer comes back and he's hunting the axe killer. I'd have been happy with that, you know?
Yeah, I'd like to see that.
Yeah, that'd be fucking decent.
Night of the Creeps 2, the axe man comes back.
The axe man cometh.
The axe man cometh.
So... Ooh. It is our sexy episode.
Well, lunatic as he is, her boyfriend says, "Let's go hunt for that comet."
Let's go look for it. What? Why? Why on earth do you want to go look for it? Because it's cool. And this is before this is before he can take a selfie with it.
He's probably going to have some radioactive...
Then again.
You know.
I don't know. You're in the car of the lady. He's probably got a boner. He's probably thinking about... You know, and
her shooting star.
But maybe her shooting star isn't as exciting as the other shooting star that's just gone. I can tell that would be quite a fun thing to go look at. So I think you would probably go look as well.
I probably would, to be honest with you. Yeah,
we could go together.
I probably would.
Let's leave those shooting stars and let's go find this big one. It's just landed over here, and off we went.
Here's my big one. Happy Valentine's Day. So. A man approaches whilst he runs off into the woods, whilst her boyfriend, or the lover, runs off into the woods. And he's wearing slippers.
Yeah.
So we immediately think, well, if he's wearing slippers, he's probably escaped from a hospital. This could well be the lunatic. Oh, it's definitely a lunatic. And a slug, what happens to the slug, comes firing into Johnny's mouth. It's a really weird start to a film.
Yeah.
We've had naked aliens. We've had a cop catching his girlfriend red-handed, a shooting star, an axe murderer with slippers on, and then a slug goes firing into Johnny's mouth.
It is fun. Like the when I was probably younger, I don't think anyone ever got out for the video shop. It's definitely never on TV. So yeah, I wish I'd seen it when I was like 15 or whatever. What year was this? Was this 87?
86. I probably would have been in my very early 20s when I managed to see this.
Yeah, because I was 9 when this came out. I was just discovering Run DMC at the time. Look at that, I'm wearing a jumper.
You're wearing the jumper.
Around that time. yeah, I wish I'd liked to have seen it then. It would have been super fun. Has it got boobs in it? It hasn't got boobs in this, has it? boobs?
I think there's some boobs in it, yeah.
Yeah, there you go. I think this has been fun.
Yeah, there's a great scene in the shower, isn't there, with all the girls all getting ready.
My 15-year-old bad self would approve.
Yeah, but us mid-40s gentlemen, we would tut now.
Civilised, we would tut and say, come surprise. On, cover yourself
you didn't
up.
Need to show that. Beer.
Cover yourself up.
Maybe just show one of them. Don't show them both. So we cut now back to the present day, or 1986 as it is, and we get to meet our two main heroes, JC, John Carpenter, and his buddy Chris. Yeah. They are geeky as fuck. They're geeky. And Chris, so JC has crutches. It's never mentioned why.
And to be honest, you don't need to. And if anything, like I matter. Said, it's this was the director's character arc for him. But to be honest, it's nice to do these little things. It just gives the character more of a quirk. It's like another thing, like another layer which you don't need to know about. But
I
also,
always loved that he had crutches.
It also hinders him from being able to run. So yeah. it's quite a good thing to do. So yeah, I think it's fine. There's no bother.
And also,
with
like. He gives an amazing speech later on where he's like, look, I'm never really going to be happy, so I might as well try and make you happy.
He does play into the character actually quite well as a disabled person whose the crutch is more of a permanent thing, the way he talks. It's not like
he's a bit depressed about it.
Post-op
really.
Or something. This is like looks like a permanent thing. And like, but I love the fact because of that, he has so much positivity. He's really like... I'll fucking do that. He's got balls. Like, he'll step up to anybody and say anything. He's got, he's like, does he think, oh, I'll pull the disabled card if anybody does anything? But I don't think so. I think he's just literally like, fuck you. But like, he could easily, he's like, oh, I'll never be able to pull. Fuck off. You could be able to pull more than that other guy. Chris is bored as shit. It's just like, why on earth does Cynthia go for him? It's like, God, you're so dull. But JC's cool. Like, he's got so much. He'd give Cynthia a lot better date if he went out of her. She'd be like laughing the whole time.
JC's definitely my favourite. He like drums on his desk. He's got
fine.
All the jokes. He's got all, you know, he's really funny.
He's
really quick.
He's very much like Brewster's pal, Evil.
Yeah, he is. Mm. He is. Cool Brewster.
Cool Brewster.
So, yeah, JC and Chris. And this is where you find out that Chris is in love with a girl whose name he doesn't even know yet. He says, oh, there she is. She's the one. And JC, straight away, is like, hey, yo. And starts
He's like a fun character. Later on, get him like a few years later when he starts drinking as well. He could be a right party dude.
He's like, what's your name? She's like, Cynthia. He's like, right, there you go. You know her name now, Cynthia, right? That's a start. Hate to break this to you, but if you ever want to marry this girl, you might have to have a conversation with her at some point. And Chris is just like, ooh. JC is brilliant. They really, I think they work well together. And they go to this perfect 80s frat party with some terrible dancing, some terrible hairstyles, clothes, music. And it's just, I just want to be there.
I bet you do.
It's brilliant.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well,
they go to this pledge house, don't they?
They do. They're going to pledge.
Is it? He's doing this though, just so he can become a frat boy, so he will impress Cynthia, correct?
Or girls generally, I think. But Cynthia is his girl that he's got his eye on right now.
And these
because
dudes,
back then, if you were in a frat, you know,
because we never have any of this shit. We have not. Don't know of this world in the slightest. I kind of. It's funny because I look at that as like another world. It's American Pie movies and things like this. It's always the party and the people being held upside down, drinking kegs and doing beer bongs and all these weird things. Like, for me, party was just fucking annihilation with people skateboarding on kitchen worktops, just trashing houses to fuck. That's the parties I went to. So it was really, I don't know, it was a strange one. But we never had fraternities over here. We don't, you know, don't have that sort of thing. So it's so funny. But these dudes, so apparently fraternity is going to be all these alpha males who we all think we're better than the other person. But they're looking at these guys going, not all fraternities could be like that, are they? I don't.
No, not all of them.
I have no idea. It must be all degrees.
Like nerdy ones and
stuff as well.
But these guys are your typical
jocks.
They've cast a load of 40-year-old men who are supposed to be like 19-year-old
No, they're probably like 28. Yeah,
They are ridiculous. There's a moment later on where they're taking selfies, and this is before smartphones, and they're taking selfies, and they're all putting sunglasses on and sort of standing there, sort of shaking their hair like, "Yeah, we're really fucking cool." They're a bunch of absolute dick douchebags, aren't they?
So Chris and JC turn up, say, "Hey guys, can we get in on this action?" And they're just like, obviously the clogs are turning. They're just like, "We can fuck these two twats up real bad. We can these nerds. We can fuck them up. We're getting to do something fucking ridiculous." And
so they do. They set him a challenge.
And they're not really. The guy's like, "We're not really going to let them in." He's like, "No, of course we're not going to let them in." Then it's, let's suck each other off.
Let's go do some 80s cocaine.
Yeah.
And the challenge that they set them, they say, "Right, if you want to join our fraternity, you need to go to the hospital, and you need to steal
a
dead body."
Yeah.
And they're like, "Jeez, this is one of the guys who's got a crutch." So you're asking a disabled guy and his geeky mate to go steal a dead body.
I watched you say, I was like, how were they going to get this out of here? Was one of them just going to carry it? But not just in the physics and the logistics of the job at hand. How were they going to sneak a corpse out? not just the carrying it. How were they going to sneak that out? It's not... I maybe put on a trolley and put a blanket over it, but it's going to be hard to do that.
You've thought about this?
I am now. Going through in my mind. It's when Sarah and I, when we're doing the High Strangers podcast, we're talking about things. Sometimes I'm thinking about, what you should have done is to evade that camera. You should have done that. And I'm thinking, God, what am I doing? I'm going into this murderer we're talking about right now and figuring out how he could have got away with it. You know, for fuck's sake. So yeah, no, I'm not going to think about that. But yes, how are they going to do that though? You know, it's ridiculous.
Well, they don't fuck around. They get straight to it, because the next scene really is just them going into the morgue, and they sort of sneak in. They, by chance, discover a secret lab that's got a naked dead guy in it, who is actually Johnny from 1959, the lover of Tom Atkins' girlfriend,
yeah.
The slug went into his mouth, and he's cryogenically frozen. In a big vat of water. So they think.
So was he frozen because of the nature of the slug thing and all that stuff, and they wanted to study him?
I should imagine the government.
Why
were,
have they
like,
just thrown
him
in
ice?
That little hospital downstairs with like no security or nothing? It's just like that should have been locked up a bit more.
Yeah, and the keypad. The reason they got in there is because JC just pressed 1, 2, 3, 4.
I think he just pressed 0 because the other guy had already pressed the other ones. And he couldn't remember the last number, so he went bing, and he goes, "I'll just press 0. Yeah.
Ridiculous. Well, they go in, they find him, they defrost him.
Why does Crutch Boy do that? I shouldn't call him Crutch Boy. JC, why does JC do that? He's just like, push the button. What are you doing? Yeah, I know we wanted a dead body, but surely this one looks a bit more impressive than the other ones. You know, it's got its own little fucking room. Like, you don't want to take that one, do you?
It's got its own room.
It's got its own little room.
You don't see his willy, though, do you?
No, he's wearing pants. He's wearing, like, little white-coloured pants. I did look, not for that
It's nice
reason.
Of the government to put little pants on him, I suppose.
Yeah, because, it's frosted over at first, because I was thinking, they frosted over that, but it's like, no, he was wearing some pants.
So he actually starts to wake up a bit, which isn't cool, which means he then spits a slug, and they run away, screaming like banshees.
I'm not going to do the impression of the guy who says that. Yes.
So it's Johnny from the prologue, which is crazy, really. He wakes up, like I said, and he spits a slug. And JC and Chris get home. This is where their bromance blossoms. You know, they talk about, JC says, "Look, man, life's too short, you know, like, I've got to make you happy, you miserable bastard."
But he says to him, "Why are you fucking laughing so much? It's And it's just where he's just like, well, what the fuck? I'm laughing because I'm doing everything you want me to do, so I'm having a laugh of it. And then the other guy's like, oh, okay, I feel a bit of a plum now. Which he should, yeah, because he was a bit...
He's done all this, yeah, all this for a girl. Do you know what I mean? Like, yeah, come on.
What's he going to get out of it? Him going, I'll see you later then. All right, cheers. I'm going to go home now then, you know.
So that's the end of our sort of opening sort of sequence, really. A lot's happened, and we've ended with a body waking back up and spitting a slug. And we now cut to Tom Atkins on a beach.
Tom Atkins on a beach looking stylish in a white suit. He looks like he's all ready to jump in Miami Vice.
He's drinking rum out of a coconut.
Yeah, but a sexy lady gives it to him in a little bikini. So he's happy as Harry, really, isn't he?
And a woman comes out the water backwards.
Yep.
Well, they filmed it backwards so that her dress is all nice and dry as she comes out the water. And then axe.
Hold on. And then an axe. Oh, it was actually.
And he has a flashback. He's got PTSD.
Mare. Indeed. Thrill me.
Yes, this is his catchphrase, thrill me. Every time he picks up a phone, every time he arrives on the scene, thrill me.
He's basically playing Bruce Willis's character for quite a few late 90s films.
Just sort of coasting through it.
Just that drunken just cop who just smokes too many cigarettes and is obsessed with one particular case. That sort of one, you know.
Yeah.
We all know
But he's never been able to let the fact go that his girlfriend was axed to death by an escaped lunatic, you know, in the 50s, and he's just carried on being a grizzled cop with a great moustache, saying thrill me to everybody.
Thrill me. He does. He's not. He is very much a Mel Gibson in First Lethal Weapon. He's quite happy to commit suicide.
Yeah, more towards the end. That's exactly what he intends to do. He also is a bit Telly Savalas in Kojak as well. Do you know what I mean?
Amazing.
Who loves you, baby?
Who loves you, baby?
Yeah, so he is called out to the lab,
basement of the hospital.
Yeah, and he gets there and he says, "Well, where's the other body? Here's the dead body, the lab technician. But where's the other body?" He says, "It's missing." And this is where he says the exact same line.
He's a bit of an arse, isn't he? Oh, I think it's because he's just a grizzled, just not happy anymore in things. He looks as happy as his IMDb picture, to be honest, Tom Atkins.
Yeah, he's not very happy looking at that, but he looks very pissed off. He says the exact same line that is said in Monster Squad when they realise the mummy's missing, which is dead guys don't just get up and walk off on their own. And obviously that was directed by Fred Decker as well, so there we go. Yeah, so the corpse is missing and the lab technician is dead. And we just see some bare feet walking along.
Yeah.
We know this is the zombie, the guy from the 50s, Johnny.
And then we cut to the ladies' dormitory house.
Yep.
And there's
Brad.
Brad, hey, it's Brad. Well,
it turns out that Brad, the head of the frat pack, frat fraternity, is actually dating Cynthia. He's got a badass car,
Bradster.
But he's an absolute
douchebag. Is it Bradster? Is that not
his... I think his license plate is Bradster, I think, yeah.
It's Bradster, baby.
He's really just an ass, to be honest. And she pretty much not dumps him, but she's like, she's really not, you know, happy with him. She gets out of the car and she heads back in. And as she walks in, this just must be an everyday occurrence for her. She walks in. Hey, I'm just going to put these in the basement. Oh, what are they? Says the other girl. Oh, these are... just some brains in jars. I'm just going to store them in our basement, if that's all right.
And yeah, we need them for a class. I told we could store them. She's like, yeah, just put in the basement.
Just keep your brains in the basement.
Strange thing to just drop in there, but why not?
And we get a classic cat scare where there's a nerdy-looking girl. Yeah, nerdy-looking girl. But the cat comes back, you know, later on because the cat gets killed and comes back as a zombie cat. So Johnny... brain blast slugs all over the girl, all over the window, sorry. Like,
yeah.
It's really... Sorry about my sound effects there.
you should have seen it from this side. No, don't do it again.
Yeah, so he sort of brain blast slugs all over the... and Cynthia sees this. Tom arrives, this is where he... Tom Atkins smells the rose as he approaches.
Tom Atkins is playing Ray Cameron, but that's boring name, so we just called him Tom Atkins.
I prefer that. And when he gets there, he finds out that the body that was spitting the slugs is actually the face. It's pretty good effect, actually. The face is completely split down the middle. Oh, it's nasty.
It's like a big, and he shows it's it. Like a big vagina head.
He shows it to all the girls. He's like, there you go, isn't that pretty?
And I would imagine,
students
I imagine that grizzly old alcoholic detective probably gets thrills from doing shit like that.
What a horrible old man.
Throw me.
Where are we at? The face is split open. So Tom gets his PTSD quick flashback of the axe, because obviously it's similar to an axe wound. And he sort of has that. The next day, though, JC and Chris get ambushed by the frat boys because they think
they did it.
They dropped a disgusting
corpse along with it, but to the girls' place instead.
Yeah.
So they're like, that's not cool. And they go along for it for a moment. And they're like, we didn't fucking do it. We had nothing to do with it, you know? But then they actually do get taken to the police station for questioning.
Well, just before that, they kick JC's crutch out from under him, and Cynthia sticks up for them, makes friends with them, pretty much dumps Brad, and becomes friends with JC and Chris. So this is how she starts, like, falling for Chris. Chris is already in love with her. But yes, then the police arrive, and they're brought in by homicide, and... again, we won't do the impression because the guy's got an Asian accent, but there's a guy there that says, I saw them running out of here screaming like banshees. And every time he says it, it just makes me laugh because it's just very funny, the delivery of it, but I'm not going to do it. But so they admit, they come clean. I don't know why Chris does this, because he's a nerd, I suppose. But he says, yes, okay, we did it.
They're very innocent nerds. That's why they've just said, to be honest, honesty is the best policy with this sort of situation, because... It's not the best situation to be in. You probably want to get out of it as soon as you can. So just come and just saying to them, look, we fucked up for it. Because they're going to be used to these types of stunts going ahead for people trying to get into frat places. Probably not to this extreme, but yeah.
But they say, you know, we didn't take the body. We definitely defrosted it, but weren't...
Sorry, isn't this the same as Bud the Chud 2? Same exact same synopsis. They need to get a dead body and they bring back Bud.
God, I haven't watched Bud the Chud 2 in about 30 years.
Go on.
What a great title, Bud the Chud.
Yeah.
Great. So they say, look, you know, the janitor saw us running out of here screaming like banshees, but we didn't have a body with us. And he's like, oh, actually, yeah, you're right, okay. So where the hell is this body then? It's very interesting. The body wakes up and he kills the janitor.
But does Tom Atkins know? Because we this is more of the story which should have been in there. There should have been Tom Atkins going, well, who is this guy? Like back at the police station type thing. And them saying, oh, that's the what goes, what? The guy, and then him realizing that's the guy that I killed. Because that's who
he
is.
I don't know if he knows it's Johnny or not from the 50s, but.
Well, no, he does later on because he says, I've already killed you once.
Oh, yeah, you're right, he does.
So
they don't make it very clear, do they?
They should have gone in. That's what I'm saying. This story just needs a little bit more of one or the other, you know, a bit more fuller.
The next couple of shots, we get a lot of little slugs zipping around everywhere. And then we, of course, we get a classic, which I love, a zombie cat, which has been killed by the brain slugs.
Yeah, it's attacks a good makeup. Girl. There's loads of good effects in this. It's like Monster Squad. Monster Squad is an amazing effect as well.
Attacks the girl, and Tom is looking at photos from the night. So he's still got all the photos from the night his girlfriend was killed.
Yeah.
And he just goes through them. Oh, I'll just look through these once more just to see if it triggers any more PTSD from me. Fucking hell.
I'll just pour another whiskey and just pass out in here, piss myself, and just start the day again.
Why is he doing that? And he gets a call to say, we found another body. It's the janitor. So people are just dropping left, right, and centre now.
It gives him a little bit of a purpose, doesn't it? Gives him
to drink.
Well, no, it gives Tom Atkins a reason to get up in the mornings if there's a few killers' bodies going missing. You know, bless him.
Meanwhile, Cynthia knocks on Chris's door, and she says, can we talk? So they go for a little walk, and they have a little chat. And she tells him about the zombie cat, which he kind of doesn't believe, but he kind of loves her, fancies her, wants to feel her bum-bum. So he goes along with that. We get the zombie janitor turn back up. So it moves at quite the pace, doesn't it?
It goes, that's what I'm saying. It's just literally, it's just bum-bum-bum-bum, which is fine, but it's just kind of almost scenes after a while. JC needs to go to the loo, so he says, I'll catch you later. Goes off to the toilet, but then we see the janitor going towards the toilet, and the janitor looks like a zombie. So we know he's infected.
And he drops to the ground, and his head splits open, and loads of slugs come firing out, and they start coming underneath the toilet door to get old JC. He's just trying to do a poop.
Presumably.
Can't do it. But he manages to burn one of them with a book of matches.
He realizes they can fire. Burn.
Fire!
Which he records himself a little tape. And we've given him that pointer to old Chris later on, which obviously helps him out with helps Cynthia out with a flamethrower, because Cynthia has it. But yeah, we'll get to that.
Well, he does get one of them go up his trousers, doesn't he?
Yeah, right up his...
Happy Valentine's.
Hopefully not up the old urethra, Franklin.
Jesus Christ. So Cynthia asks Chris to the dance. Of course he says yes. So they're going to prom together. And Tom takes Chris off for a chat. This is where he tells him his story many years ago. And he tells him all about...
What, in a trailer voice?
And he says, I just love that bit, like you said earlier. And he was always going to tell this story. It doesn't matter what Chris thinks of it. Chris actually is like the audience at one point,
Why has he just gone to Chris?
Why are you telling me this?
Why is he? He's literally just like, here, dude. He doesn't care who it is. He just wants to get this person back to his house, make them drink whiskey, get them on the same level as him, and go, years ago. Like, oh my God.
And he reveals that he buried the body of the axe murderer underneath the sorority mother's cottage. And we cut to
a sorority mother's cottage.
And the axe murderer, of course, being buried with his axe, has come back now as a slug brained space zombie.
I do love his story though, just the whole sort of like, it just goes, I found him, I had my revenge, I tracked him on my off hours. This is the guy, kids there going, oh my God. Yeah. You'd be so scared of this drunken Tom Atkins with his big moustache with a gun just saying the shit to you. You'd be like,
Chris says, oh God. On your own? And he says, no, I had my gun with me.
It's just like, oh God.
Yeah, and he killed him and buried him under the sorority mother's cottage, along with the axe. And like I say, you know, that's a bad move, because
that's
when the space
cool.
zombies...
I like that bit where you get this really good skeleton just break out of a floor with an axe.
I know,
axe.
What the fuck?
So cool, but again, it's just another thing. It's like, oh God, you do one or the other. But yeah, it is quite cool. I like that scene.
It is a lot. They have fitted a lot
it's
of a, things
it's
into
pushing
this.
It a lot, yeah.
Yeah. The cops start looking for the killer, and they're almost axed by this zombie thing. And they corner the zombie, they blow his head off, and slugs go everywhere. So, you know, they have...
It's not good, really. They need to freeze it, or, like you say, burn it. That's probably the best way of dealing with this.
Well, luckily, there is now a...
Electrocution.
Well, luckily, we cut straight to a shower montage with all the girls getting ready.
Of course we do. It's an 80s movie.
Lots of boobs, lots of people blow drying their hair. And we also cut to all the guys getting ready as well. They're all sort of shaving and putting their aftershave on as well, blow drying their hair. And everyone's getting ready for the big dance. But it's all going to go wrong because, well, what happens next?
Well, the dates turn up, don't they?
They do. But before that, Chris is in his tux and he finds a tape, a cassette.
Oh, yeah.
And And this is chilling. This is chilling because he presses play and it's Chris, it's JC transforming into a zombie, but he's recorded himself and he said, I can feel them inside my brain.
When I first started making music on a computer, like, you know, making drum beats and all that sort of stuff, I sampled this whole thing and put like music underneath it. So I know this bit really well, this one scene. But yes, yeah, it's interesting.
It's really good.
It's a great audio.
It's really
piece.
Good. Yeah. It reminds me of the very first Resident Evil on the PlayStation, where there is a part in that game where you find a diary and you start reading through the diary, and the diary is of a guy that's slowly turning into a zombie.
Oh, cool.
And by about the sixth or seventh page, the words don't make any sense, and they're just like blood scrawling across the page. And it reminds me of that kind of thing. It was just, I think it's really well done. And we know, wow, man, like JC's dead. Like Chris is on his own. They've killed his best mate, you know. We thought he was invincible. He had the crutch. He felt invincible.
I know, great. We're left with Chris. Yay, no personality, Chris.
Yay,
great. Let's focus on him for a while.
But at the end of the tape, he does say, fire or heat will kill them. And then he finishes with, I love you, man. And again, it's like a really nice, I love you, man. And he does. He loves him. And we find JC's body in the bathroom. And, of course, it's a mess. He's got a vagina head as well.
Yeah.
But we get the party bus going here now, don't we?
Ooh, it's the party bus.
The frat guys have got their own party bus. It's probably a 2-block drive to the party, but they decide to get a bus there to make it special.
It'd be great though, wouldn't it? Hanging out with Bradster, getting drunk with him for 2 blocks.
Bradster. Get the 80s cocaine. And then a dog walks into the middle of the road.
I imagine it's a lot more purer.
I should imagine it was. And the dog decides it's going to spit some slugs. So the slugs are just infecting everything, whether cat, dog, man, janitor, whatever it is, infected. And it makes the bus crash.
Same sort of thing as Slugs, really, that movie. I can't remember that movie very well, but it's the same thing, is it? Have you seen Slugs?
Yeah, I like Slugs, yeah.
Okay. Is it the same principle?
No, they're not like brain zombie slugs from space. They're just slugs that will like get in your mouth and kill you.
Okay.
Slugs are gross, aren't they? Sorry to any listeners out there that are slugs.
Is that Cronenberg movie? Is it The Brood as well? Was that the same sort of thing?
Yeah. No, that's nothing to do with it.
No? Okay.
That's about your emotions growing into like...
There was a movie with something going in the mouth, a Cronenberg one.
Oh, no, actually, I'm thinking of a different one. You might be right, actually. There is something with... Oh, Shivers you're thinking of.
Ah, yes. Okay.
Yeah, we covered that when we did our Cronenberg episode.
That's what I thought, yeah, in the swimming pool. They're all getting in, they're all getting freaky in the swimming pool at the end. Anyway, carry on.
Bus crashes, avoiding that dog that's spitting out slugs. So Tom Atkins decides to head on down to his buddy.
He turns his gas off before he leaves, though, because he's not going to commit suicide now.
No, he's not going to do that. It's crazy that this guy, every time you see him, he's essentially pulling a Martin Riggs and on the verge of... You know.
Isn't that interesting, though? Because his writing partner wrote Lethal Weapon.
It is, yeah. That's true. That's true. It does add a certain level, a layer to our hero, doesn't it? When they're unhinged. Because obviously, like, Lethal Weapon is called Lethal Weapon because Mel Gibson's character is a lethal weapon. He's just a bomb ready to go off.
Yeah, and Tom Atkins is obviously in Lethal Weapon.
Yeah, he gets killed in
so they're all doing
drinking
doing
the eggnog.
You're all doing a little you shame yours, I'll shame mine.
Tom Atkins shows up in so many movies, actually.
No, he's always not that many, actually.
I watched something the other day and he popped up and I thought, what the hell was he doing in this?
What, is it later in his career?
Yeah, it wasn't very good, did it? But I still like seeing him popping up in things.
I liked him in Valentine's Day. What's it called?
My Bloody Valentine?
My Bloody Valentine remake. I liked him in that.
Yeah, it's all right.
But anyway, he realises he needs some hardcore pornography. No, hardcore weapons.
Well, it's Valentine's episode after all. Well, if you need some hardcore, you go and see Dick.
Dick is going to give you the hardcore. But he wants paperwork.
Dick Miller.
It's great.
And I love his way he does this. Now he's like, yeah, yeah, of course, I can help you out with that. You want a flamethrower? No problem at all. Then he pauses and he says, I'm going to need to see that paperwork, though.
Yeah, and he says, oh, there's a problem about that. And then basically and he slowly
starts loading his gun.
Getting his shotgun all sorted and points at him.
He's just unhinged. And the kid that's with
poor
him is just
Dick
like,
Dick Miller. He's just trying to do his little job. Oh, bless Dick Miller.
I love Dick Miller and everything he shows up
in. I love Dick.
Happy Valentine's, listeners.
Zombie Brad
shows up at the sorority house.
Cynthia doesn't even notice and takes him by the hand and sits on the steps with him and tells him, I was gonna call. And he's like, oh.
She does it in such a way that she's like, she's worried about it breaking his heart, so she slowly walks him out and she sits him down in front of him. And little does she know that while she's there, like pouring out her heart, like, we're just not going to work. Behind him, just these 100 slugs are just firing out of his mouth.
Yeah. Because this movie is fun. If you want to have a fun time, have a few beers and watch this movie. Absolutely. Do you know what I mean? Then you don't care if a story does whatever the story does, because it's just all these scenes of all these things, which is all fun and really well good makeup. It's all good. I love the zombie look as well. It's quite nice.
Yeah, everything about it, all the effects are fun, really. Some of them are a bit...
It's all prosthetic, obviously, you know, it's that time.
Yeah. There's a few slugs effects that are a bit... haven't aged as well, but it is what it is. We get the zombie frat bus turns up as well now.
So are you saying that there was someone zombified driving a bus down the street?
Well, how did it get here?
Well,
because their boys all turn up.
That's what
they?
I'm saying. Obviously, while driving it, but you say it's only two blocks, so maybe he just got lucky.
Maybe.
What were they all doing when they're driving? They all just stand and go round and round with each other. Hilarious. Make a movie about that.
Well, don't worry, because Chris and Tom Atkins turn up and they flame Brad, and they start flaming and killing all the other zombies as they arrive.
Yep.
And they barricade themselves in the sorority house with all the girls. And this is where Tom Atkins delivers the infamous line. This line is up there with, I came here to do two things, kick ass and chew bubblegum.
Yep.
And this is, they want the good news or the bad news. The good news is your dates are here. The bad news is they're all dead. And it's just classic Tom Atkins delivery. No one saw that coming, but everybody knows now that some people probably know that line and have never seen this film or don't know what film it's from. It's a classic line, but and it is very funny.
But Atkins is in there with his little handgun, and like I say, Cynthia has the flamethrower. Then we cut to basically Chris saying to Cynthia, just do it, just burn. Why have you given the person who's apprehensive of using the flamethrower the flamethrower? You don't have time for diddy-daddling around with this. There's slug-firing zombies coming towards you from all directions. You need a proactive flamethrowing person to take them all out. You need Leonardo DaVinci DiCaprio in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood when he does that woman in the pool.
Okay.
You need that. You need that proactive person.
Well, we get Tom Atkins with an aerosol flame. An aerosol cannon of flame at one point. And we also get Chris doing his best Lionel from Brain Dead when he pulls a lawnmower out and he goes to town on a few of the zombies then, which I always quite enjoy.
This here, though, it seems to be a load of scenes mashed together. Now, I don't know if they filmed more and it's for editing's sake, or it's edited a bit badly. It's a shame, though. There's no tension to it. It's literally just some scene.
Yeah.
Which is a shame. There's no, oh my God, it just happens.
I think it feels like that because what we've discussed earlier and throughout is that there is almost too much mishmash together here, too many elements, too many genres, that although there is a story, it's so thin that all they could really do is do a series of fun scenes and special effect jobs.
Which is fun.
Mash it all together. Yeah, and exactly, like you said, you're stoned, you're drunk, whatever you're doing on a night, you're having fun with this. Really,
I just
almost
wanted something more, like a little bit more, because I think it could have been made as a super good film, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. Well, the slugs realise that there's brains in the basement, as we just talked about earlier. So they all start into the basement, and our heroes head down there, and they find Tom Atkins in there. He's got some duct tape over his mouth to stop the slugs from going in.
Good work.
And there's a giant pile of disgusting, quivering slugs in the corner, all sort of going la 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 la. It's gross. And he is basically going to just blow up the whole.
Yeah,
he's going to kill himself.
It's a more honourable way of ending it, I suppose. Really, you're going to do this massive thing and help people, you know.
But there's a brilliant bit where he rips the tape off his mouth to tell them something, and a slug just comes flying out of his mouth, and he just catches it in midair.
Not this time. Yeah.
It's so good. And he says 20, and you think, why is he saying that? Then he says 19, and then Chris and Cynthia realize, oh shit, he's counting down, we better get out of here. So they start running out because he's been pouring petrol all over the basement, gasoline. And as they get outside, Chris is counting in his head, 2, 1, and then he just says, thrill me, detective. And as he says that, boom, the whole sorority explodes. Chris and Cynthia kiss.
Yep.
And we end with a little doggy running over. Hello, little doggy. Oh, there's a slug in its mouth.
Yep.
It's a zombie dog.
It was. So it could keep on going. Yeah.
It could. I'm surprised they didn't make a sequel. I really am surprised. They could have made a sequel.
I don't know how this done financially. I have no idea. Yeah, I don't know. They probably could have done. Maybe.
I'm glad they didn't, though, you know. But they could have made them a sequel to this. They could have made a sequel to Monster Squad. I just think in the 80s, it wasn't so much about sequels, really. It wasn't all about the franchise like it is now. You know, obviously, in the 80s, we had Halloween, Nightmare on Elm Street, Jason. But they were the big ones, really. You didn't fuck with the big boys. Other little ones that came along, little horror movies like this. This was a tiny little horror movie, you know, when it came out. Horror comedy as well, really niche. People probably didn't. This is one of the ones that wouldn't have done very well for about 15, 20 years, I should imagine. And then it becomes a cult film when VHS come. You know, everyone starts, oh, have you seen this? Borrow this. I'll video, you know, I'll record this. I'll pirate this. Mm. It's a lot of fun. There are definitely, from a reviewer's eye, there's definitely some flaws. I do often find myself getting bored watching this film. Although I've watched it a lot. I probably watch it once or twice a year, usually, because it's on Horror Channel so much. But I do find myself switching off a little bit here and there, or looking at my watch a little bit. But it's still a short burst of fun. And if you haven't seen it, if you haven't seen it, you should definitely see it. It's definitely one to tick off. But yeah, thumbs up.
Yeah, thumbs up. It's a fun movie. If you're a horror fan and have not seen this, you should definitely watch this film. It's not really a switch your brain off movie, but it is what it is. It's got a load of fun elements in it. It's got loads of horror shit. It's 80s. It's got some good effects. It's all right.
It's in the same vein as Return of the Living Dead, you know, Vamp. We've talked about some of the movies.
It's got a good front cover, silly. With the hand on the door.
It's got Tom Atkins being Tom Atkins, really.
It's kind of like an EC comic. It won the Tales from the Crypt type comics. You know, Crypt of the Vault of the. Oh, I can't remember what it all were.
Crypt Keeper and all that shit.
Yeah, basically, the EC comics have those actual stories. It feels very much like that in some sense. It's fine.
And it feels like they've remade a 50s B-movie and then just jazzed it up for the 80s. Because, you know, I could imagine, you know, brain slugs from outer space sounds like something that I would have caught on Channel 4, you know, that was made in the 1950s. Brain slugs from outer space! You know, you can imagine that. Zombies from outer space or something like that.
Well,
you know,
the writers are going to be coming from an influence of growing up from those films anyway. So, and obviously they have that flashback to that. So it is them looking at those golden days which they grew up with, those 50s B-movies, especially the science fiction ones with aliens. It's a fun movie. You should definitely check it out. I'll give it a thumbs up. It's got flaws. I said all that at the beginning, so I don't want to be a downer on it because it is fun.
Yeah, but we love it and it's good. And it's about time
we
covered it.
It's got Tom Atkins. So, you know, can't go wrong, really.
It's got Tom Atkins. There you go.
Yeah.
Right, well, talking of going back to the 50s and the 80s,
yeah.
It's time to go back to 2018 if you're ready.
I'm ready.
You ready to jump in the... in the Love Mobile, and
it's all pink this time.
The Love Tunnel.
False fur? Is that what it is? All pink false fur everywhere. It's literally everywhere. There's no windows.
Including these fake fur pink handcuffs. If I can get you to put these on.
Is this like the new seatbelt?
There's a third handcuff that goes here. Let me just put this on.
All
right.
Right. I'm strapped. I'm ready.
Right, let's go back to 2018. Are you ready for this?
Let's go.
Here we go.
Whoa! What's this machine?
This is my time machine.
Your time machine?
Yeah. For the next 5 minutes, we are going to be the Time Team.
The Time Team! Whoa!
What's this? Look at that!
Look at that!
Oh, he's been dead 100 years! Look at that!
That's the Statue of Liberty coming out of the sand.
Oh, there's a dinosaur!
Oh my god, look at that! It's something else.
Here we are.
Not
too far away in the past, actually, no.
No, I can sort of see around me. Oh, I can see something. Oh no, I can't. There's still pink false fur on the windows. So I can't even see anything. So you have to just tell me stuff. Okay, we're going out. Okay.
Yes, I'd like to show you around 2018. This was the year we had a royal wedding. Prince Harry and Meghan Markle got married.
Oh, they've been pushed out, haven't they? Or they've chosen themselves to leave, and it's all like a episode of EastEnders or something, isn't it? The royal family at the moment. It's sort of like a little drama. Pedo's here, people leaving here, you know.
Yeah. Just for the record, because I know Prince Andrew is a listener, we don't know if you're definitely a pedo, but you are a massive pedo.
Yeah, of course, because, I suppose you would just pay someone off you've never met before.
12 million.
Never met him.
No, I definitely never met her. I definitely never touched her up when she was 14, but I'm going to give her 12 million to shut up and go away.
So, everybody knows what's going on here. Everybody. So there's no point even talking about it. We all know what's going on.
So that was the royal wedding. We digressed. Also 2018, Kanye Believe, who visited the White House. Kanye West.
Yeah.
Went there in his MAGA hat, in his Make America Great Again hat, and had a chat with Donald Trump.
But basically the world goes a bit weird at times and you just get weird things going on. That's a weird thing going on. We just go like, it's a thing that's happened, and then we just carry on. And it means nothing really. It really means nothing, but it's something.
There was a time that Kanye was interested, or Ye, as he's now called, was interested in becoming president, fucking hell, as well. Thank God someone talked him out of that as well, because
I think that was a misdirect, though, wasn't it? An orchestrated misdirect to look over here at Kanye doing this while we do something else, I think.
Well, there was an interesting thing that happened in 2018. Do you remember the Thai soccer team?
No.
So there was some young boys, there were 12 of them, and their soccer coach got trapped in an underground cave in Thailand for 18 days.
Oh, yes.
And the whole world was watching, holding a breath. We wondered if they would ever make it out. And they rescued them all.
Yeah.
It was an incredible story. They all appeared on Ellen. Of course they fucking did. And yeah,
she's
what
been
an incredible story.
Cancelled now, hasn't she? I put my little fingers up there. Cancel. Is that a big word? Cancel.
She's not a very nice person, though, from what I've heard in real life.
I'm sure not. Some people should probably be cancelled.
Well, somebody sent an incorrect text message in 2018 to the entire Hawaii.
Entirety of Hawaii, the island, the population.
Everybody in Hawaii on January the 13th received a text message that said, "Emergency alert, ballistic missiles are threatening inbound to Hawaii.
What?
Seek immediate shelter. This is not a drill."
I don't even remember this. What the fuck?
And then the government, American government, said, "Oh shit, really sorry about that. That was a mistake."
Who were they sending that to then?
Well, that's just the text that they've got set up, ready to go.
And it accidentally went out to everybody. What did they all do?
In Hawaii, they all shit themselves and worried. And some people started getting ready. It said immediately, "This is not a drill. Seek shelter right now." I'll read it once more. "Emergency alert. Ballistic missile threat is inbound to Hawaii. Seek immediate shelter. This is not a drill." One man had a heart attack.
Yeah. Oh, you know how awkward that situation is going to be when that dude, there's a few people in the room and that dude and the woman have just been having sex with each other, or like a man and man having sex and the girlfriend's like, "What?" And they're like, "I thought it was the end." Right, it's awkward now, isn't it? Yeah.
The former Secretary of Defense, William J. Perry, said in a tweet, "Sorry about that. Someone pressed the wrong button."
Wow. What button were they supposed to press? That's what I want to know.
The wrong button. Everyone in Hawaii.
What was the right one?
Who knows? He probably just wanted to text his mum, "I'll see you on Sunday for Sunday dinner, mum."
Yeah.
But he sent the wrong text.
Yeah.
In 2018, people were stupid, Gav, as well.
That must have been so bad. Did anybody actually manage to get to any bunkers? I want to know more about this one. It's just fascinating. Like, how much shit you up, though?
I think they rectified it within minutes, but...
Right.
Even so.
Good. When you get the next text. Oh, thank fuck for that.
Sorry about that, everyone.
Jesus Christ, put the kettle on. Oh, my God.
Bob leant on the wrong button. Sorry about that. Bob's been fired. In 2018, people were stupid, particularly
people
children.
People have always been stupid, Dan.
Yes, but there was something called the Pod Challenge, the Tide Pod Challenge, that became very big in 2018, where it was, can you put a laundry pod in your mouth and hold it in there until it dissolves? But then children started getting really sick and poisoned from it.
I don't even hear of this. Why are people so stupid?
Why do you think? Right, okay,
so
now.
It's not going to taste good, is it?
So hang on, now, because since then, at the end of every commercial or advertisement,
they have to say, "Don't eat this."
They say, "Yeah, don't eat it," or they say that every single time I buy it now, they've got childproof lids. I can't fucking open them. I'm 44 and I can't open the lid to get the pods out to wash my clothes. I don't want to eat them. Why would I want to eat them? So, Poison Control received 86 calls because it went viral. Kids were doing it. You know, like the drink challenge where kids were slamming bottles of vodka and stuff like that at that time?
Yeah, right, yeah.
Ridiculous. Absolutely ridiculous.
Always happens. There's a crate challenge, wasn't there, where people getting hurt from that. There's always something comes on. Ice bucket challenge wasn't as bad. At least people just got cold.
Yeah, I gave to charity for that as well.
Mm.
So, talking of things getting cancelled, though, you mentioned this earlier. Let's talk about Roseanne.
Oh, was it? Oh, right. Okay. She's got a few issues, and she was missed her drugs. I think was her reasoning for saying some stuff.
She made some very anti-Jewish comments.
Yeah, I thought it was like a race type
to do with the Holocaust and burning in the oven and stuff. I won't bother repeating it now. You can Google it, guys, if you want to know. But she came back in 2018 with a new season of Roseanne, the show. But after 3 months of episodes, she tweeted that former senior advisor Valerie Jarrett, who was Barack Obama's senior advisor, was a monkey or an ape. So racist comment there.
Was the comeback of Roseanne, was that doing all right at the time?
It was doing okay, but it was immediately cancelled.
Why did she need to even say anything? Why can't she just not go and do something else? Why can't she put her feet up and watch Police Academy? Why did she need to do, you know?
Well, the beautiful thing about it, the revenge is that the show was cancelled and then it started up again as The Conners, and they basically did a few episodes of the show, but in that Roseanne had died. Her character was killed off in it, I think. So,
right.
What's the point?
Well, they probably had to fulfil contracts.
And now everybody hates Roseanne. So, there we go. You mentioned Aretha Franklin. She passed away in 2018.
Bless her. R-E-S-P-C-T. I know what it means to me.
And at her funeral, Chaka Khan, Smokey Robinson and Stevie Wonder all performed. Imagine that.
Amazing.
That's brilliant, isn't it?
Yeah.
Stevie Wonder. Bless him. He's great, isn't he?
Yep.
Gav's currently doing a Stevie Wonder impression, which involves moving your head from left to right.
Playing the keyboard. I've got a little keyboard here, so.
Isn't she lovely?
Incredible singer. And really, really versatile. Really versatile musician. Like, songs are great.
He is an incredible harmonica player. Did you know that?
No, but I can imagine so. Yeah, he's really good artist.
There's a song by the Eurythmics called Talking to an Angel. You know the song, must be talking to an angel.
Or Annie Lennox.
There's a harmonica solo on there. And one day I thought, who does this? And I Googled it, and it was Stevie Wonder. They just said to him, Stevie, can you do a harmonica solo on our song? And he said, yeah, all right, I'll do that.
Good on him.
Yeah, good on him. So we've gone slightly off there a little bit, but there we go. Millie Bobby Brown quit Twitter in 2018.
Stranger Things lady.
Because she was bullied on Twitter.
It's because people are cunts.
It's true, they are. Relating to horror and things, also 2018 was the year of the Suicide Forest video. Do you remember this? You look confused. Logan Paul, the YouTube star, he went into the Suicide Forest in Japan.
Boxing matches.
He found a body.
He's a YouTube star, isn't he?
Yeah. So on his YouTube videos, he went into the Japanese Suicide Forest, and he did find somebody had killed themselves. And he videoed it and took pictures of it and got a huge amount of backlash, and YouTube kicked him off. And now he's back. Everyone loves him again, and he's doing documentaries and fighting people and... But yeah, he basically used someone's body to just get more likes.
It's one of those things, isn't it? Because that's all of these content creators, all these people, they are primarily, because it's a thing. If you're one of these people, YouTube stars and that, you've got you have to take it seriously, full time job. You're looking for content to be putting out all the time. I'd hate it. I'd feel so under pressure with it. You have to do it all the time, so you're always looking for stuff. And if you go into a suicide forest, well, why are you going into a suicide forest in the first place? Are you going there just
exactly?
It's like, what is the reason for it? So if you find someone, you're gonna document it, because that's what you're gonna do. Would I document it, being someone that does do documentary stuff?
You wouldn't, I don't think.
I don't think I would. I think...
You talk of it.
I think I'd talk off camera of it, yeah. I think I don't think you could. I can
imagine he's talking head, like, oh, I stopped recording at that point because we found a body, and that's what he probably should have done.
I think, like, the camera panning up slightly to the feet or whatever, if it's a hanging or whatever, and then just stopping there and just being like, you know, we could not, you know. It's out of respect, isn't it, for the dead?
I think he got too big for his boots. As well.
Yeah, it's the wrong thing to do when it comes down to it. It's an egotistical content creator thing, I think.
Well, this was also the year we said goodbye to Stephen Hawking, one of the greatest minds ever to grace the planet
and
Earth.
People are still trying to work out his things.
His equations. Stephen Hawking.
Obviously,
has another thing.
Well, those times when me and Hawkins would hang out, Hawkins and Hall, we called it. We had our little drinking sessions where we hanged out together, and our great minds would intersperse with each other with like lightning. We would be back and forwards with thoughts and ideas, and I would at times talk him down and say, "You're wrong, Hawking! Wrong!" And I'd push his wheelchair away so he couldn't get back to me. "You're wrong!" I'd say, and I'd give him the right equation, and he'd be like, "Whore, you're incredible." Like, oh, no.
He'd be like, fuck you. Also, this year of great debate, 2018. When you listened to that little bit of audio, did you hear Yanni or did you hear Laurel?
What?
Yanni. Laurel.
What are you saying to me?
Yanni. Laurel.
Is it having a dream?
Do you not remember this?
No.
So, do you remember the dress thing from a couple of years before where it was like, what colour is this dress?
No.
On the picture, and everyone was like, is this colour or this colour?
Was this all over Facebook or something, was it?
It was all over everything.
Maybe I wasn't looking at the time to social stuff.
Well, there was an audio sound recording, and people were arguing whether they heard one thing or another, and the words were Yanni or Laurel.
Was everybody bored? Was everybody just waiting for COVID to take over because they're bored?
Yeah, I think they probably were. I think we probably were.
Who cares? But there what we go. He was a shit.
But yeah, Charles Barkley was the only person in the world that thought it was neither Yanni nor Laurel. Charles Barkley said, "It sounds like the word donut to me."
See, that thing in my head, I think I remember Charles Barkley and donut. Those words work in my head. I think I've read that, but I didn't know what it was, and then I ignored it. Yeah.
Fantastic. Well, that's good. That's really good. What else happened in 2018? Because I think it's probably about time we got onto some movie stuff, really, as well. I think that was pretty... Oh, we did also say good... This is the last thing now. Toys R Us closed down pretty good.
End of an era. Yes. I bought my first ever horror makeup kit as a kid from Toys R Us. So excited. My Christmas money, and I spent it on a horror movie makeup kit.
There we go. Good lad. So, 2018, let's talk about general movies. Obviously, there's a lot of Marvel and DC films at the time. Black Panther, Avengers. We had a Transformers movie called Bumblebee. Deadpool 2 came out this year. Just your usual crap come flying out, you know. It makes you realise just how many superhero movies there are these days, doesn't it? When you go back like this and look at this. Yeah. Even The Incredibles came back. Incredibles 2 came back this year.
Yeah, it came out way... I really liked the first one. I thought, I'd love to see what happens again. And then they made it like 18 years later or something. Like, what are you doing?
We got Solo, the Star Wars movie, came out this year, which was all right. Really.
I think I watched it. I don't remember any of it.
Fair enough. It's got Chewbacca in it, which is quite good. Mm. You know. Mary Poppins came back from Mary Poppins Returns. Ocean's 8.
Nah.
An all-female cast. No, not seen that.
Nah.
Mamma Mia 2. Here We Go Again.
No, I didn't see that. No. I didn't watch many movies this year.
Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. I know you saw that.
I did, and I really like that, and I have it on Blu-ray, in fact.
It's really, really good. Star Wars Episode 8, The Last Jedi, came out this year as well. So a couple of Star Wars movies this year. Yeah. Loads of other stuff came out. We're here to talk about horror. So horror movies. And it was a quite a good year for horror. You ready?
Go.
Quiet Place.
I've got part two on DVD. I picked up in a charity shop the other day.
I've not seen it.
I know.
Have you seen it?
I picked up a charity shop for 25 pence, went in Sainsbury's, and it's still on the shelves brand new.
What?
Yeah.
25p?
Yeah. It's four movies for a pound. I got that and like a couple other movies, and it was 25 pence. And the other movies were brand new as well. I was like, that's a bit weird.
We got a very creepy film that not many people really talk about that came out this year called Possum.
Sarah is a big fan.
I know she is. And I am as well. It's a very unsettling film. I'd like to watch it again, but it left me with a very strange feeling. But it's quite hard to describe. It's British, gritty, psychological, but not very, some disturbing imagery in it. And I would recommend it to anybody who hasn't seen it. If you're scared of dolls and dolls' heads, there's some weird stuff going on in that.
I've not seen it. I don't know if I want to see it. I don't know why, because I do like the actor. So I don't know.
Yeah, he's very good. Talking of heads, Hereditary came out this year.
I thought Hereditary came out this year, and I thought you were going to say that. I didn't. I've seen it once. I don't need to watch it again. I thought it was all right.
I didn't like it the first time round, and I've seen it three times now.
I liked it a bit more the second and third time.
Yes.
We must have sat there and watched it together. That's the only time I've seen it, and I didn't mind it.
Yeah, I liked it a lot more the second and even the third time. Decent. It's pretty, well, it's very good, let's be honest. It's very good. Slender Man came out this year. Don't remember it.
Not seen
Couldn't say anything about it. Rubbish.
Okay.
The Cloverfield Paradox. Everyone was going crazy about this film. Oh, my God, it's straight to Netflix.
The spaceship the Cloverfield one. I've not Paradox. Seen it. No.
Really. Quite poor.
What was I doing this year? I definitely wasn't watching many films.
Annihilation with Natalie Portman. That was a Netflix one.
Yes, because the director of photography played a load of it at the place in town and did a little talk on it, how he shot it and stuff. That was good to watch on a big screen. I don't mind that film actually. There's some bits that I really like. I like the music score for that actually.
Another entry in the Wannaverse this year with The Nun.
Corrin's movie.
Corrin's movie. The Nun. And Truth or Dare came out this year, which I was really excited to watch from the trailers. Then when I watched it, I was like, this is just another, it's like Final Destination, that kind of thing, but not very good. However, we did get The Predator this year, which
that wasn't very good.
I was a big fan of. You didn't like it.
I really liked it. And I thought it was such a waste and a shame because it brought back Fred Decker and Shane Black.
Black and Decker. There we go. Upgrade came out this year, which is more science fiction than horror, but I'm a big fan of it. Remember that one? It's got not Tom Hardy, but Tom Hardy.
That was all right. That film. I've forgotten all about that movie because you've got to remember since we've had COVID, really gone to shit. what is it called?
What else happened this year? It's called Upgrade.
Upgrade, that's right. Yeah, that was all right, actually. Yeah. Kind of Universal Soldier-y-like, wasn't it, really, sort of thing?
It was a bit Robocop-y as well. Hmm. It was kind of like John Wick. It's like John Wick meets Universal Soldier, I would describe it as.
Yeah, I agree.
Which is a great concept in itself. A film that I know you were a big fan of this year, and I know a lot of people were. Apostle.
Yeah, I've seen this multiple times because that setting is exactly how I'd love to make the new film that I want to make look like that.
It's very good, isn't it?
Some really good bits in it, and I really like that Brown character, the main actor, Saint Brown. I thought he's really good in that retro looking movie. Where he comes back as a soldier's buddy, and he comes back and just beats people up and just goes a bit crazy.
Oh, yes.
Fuck's sake.
Daniel, I know who you mean. The Guest.
The Guest. Wingard. Adam Wingard made it, didn't he? Yeah.
Yes, he did.
I feel it was good now. I like it. I like that movie, Apostle. It's good.
Unsane came out of the show, which I was a big fan of. Have you seen Unsane?
No.
Yeah, really, really worth checking that one out. One that I was disappointed with was Sandra Bullock in Bird Box. Everybody was talking about this
one. I still haven't seen it. I was going to watch it, and Jay's like, no, don't watch it now. We'll watch it another time. And then Jay went and watched it. So I've still not seen that film. I forgot all about it as well. I don't really like Sandra Bullock. I don't look for movies with her in, quite frankly.
I know what you were doing this year, because this next movie, I know exactly where you saw this and who with. Overlord.
Oh, I was on a date. That's me and Sarah's date movie. That's our first film.
So you guys are falling head over heels in love.
Like, people have a song, that's our movie. A Nazi zombie Overlord movie.
It's really good. It's really good.
I was thinking about watching it again. In the cinema, it was brilliant, because it's just that first opening shot is really good in the cinema.
Yeah,
it's great.
It's really, really good. We also got Halloween, which you and I went to watch together.
We did. We got together and we watched that. That was a rarity of us being together, which is rare nowadays, and in the cinema together.
Yeah, much better than our cinema trip before, which was Ghostbusters.
The female-led one. I was going to say the girly one, but that would sound like I'm trying to be dismissive of it, because there's women in it, which I'm not at all.
Goosebumps 2 dropped in 2018. It's all right. The first one's better, though, in my opinion. Mandy.
Yeah.
Nicolas Cage.
That's a crazy movie.
It's off the wall, and we are going to be covering it at some point soon, I think.
We did debate on doing it soon, but it's been pushed back a little bit.
Kate Pollock will be pleased that Suspiria came out the show. I went to the cinema with her to watch that, the remake of Suspiria.
Yeah.
Reimagining. Mm. And I think I said it was one of my favourite movies of the year, I think.
It's so funny. All these horror films that you're saying, I've literally just put out of my mind, because I think, COVID coming into the existence really just made me forget all these films, really. Yeah, I watched that movie. Yeah. It was all right. I'm a big fan of the original Suspiria.
We had a lot of movies come out. Insidious, The Last Key, Polaroid, The First Purge, just loads and loads of random stuff. Hellfest was a really good one, which I enjoyed. Have you seen Hellfest?
No, you're saying all these movies, I've not seen any of them. I really wasn't watching films. It's so bizarre. That's so weird. This is the year. This is the only year so far, I think, going through all these, I haven't watched a lot of these films when they came out. Really weird.
Well, that is what we got in 2018. Some really good ones. Some classy stuff like the Suspiria remake and Hereditary. And The Quiet Place really blew me away. I wish I'd have seen that in the cinema, actually, because I could imagine that would have been an amazing experience to watch in a cinema full of people all trying to be very quiet.
You'd be like, when can I open my crisps? For God's sake.
If somebody opened a can of Coke at the wrong time, you'd all look around at them like, shut up!
Just quiet!
Because I was watching it, I was holding my breath watching that just at home. I thought it was amazing, really. That was one of my favourites. And I really enjoyed going to watch Halloween with you. I liked Upgrade. I really liked Annihilation, the Natalie Portman one.
Yeah.
I thought that was really good. And I think my favourites from the year were things like Mandy and Overlord. Overlord was definitely one of the most fun ones from the year. A mixed bag. I don't know which ones I'd scoop up in my arms and take back with me. Probably Overlord and a couple of the other ones, but I think Overlord's probably one of my favourites from the year. It's an interesting year, 2018, for horror. Little did we know that it would be drying up in the next couple of years during the pandemic, and everything would be delayed or put on hold. And so it'd be interesting to see when we get to 2020,
yeah,
what the state of horror was. But that was 2018, Gav. What are your final thoughts before we jump back in the pink love wagon and go back to the present day?
It's a forgetful year for me, because I don't know where I was thinking about stuff then, but yeah, didn't see many of those films. But anyway, let's fuck off of this. Let's get going.
Let's fuck off. Let's go. Bye-bye, 2018.
Goodbye.
2022, here we come.
Maybe it's just not meant to happen. I've tried everything. Am I sexy?
Of course you
are. Yes, I am.
Jesus.
Jennifer!
I even went on this dating website specifically for virgins and I got one response from a 12-year-old Chinese boy.
You turn 30 on Sunday, don't you? Right, well, I promise you now, you're going to lose your virginity before you're 30. This is my present to you, my brother. This has got to work fast. I don't think, act, occupy.
Would you like to go out for a fuck time in lotion?
Oh, shit.
Fun. Sorry. Fun time in London.
Yeah, we'd love to, wouldn't we?
Yeah.
You'd love... what?
Lord Roy.
Absolutely not.
Syringe. Chloroform. Knife. Let's do this.
Ladies!
So your sister's there?
Yeah.
Cool. That's cool. I think I'm having a panic attack, alright? It just doesn't make any sense, does it? Why would these two beautiful girls just turn up out of the blue and be interested in us?
And what if we let them go? This gym's really nice, it's different from the others. You are doing it.
Strippers' names? But you're not strippers?
No.
Shame.
Double Date from 2017. Rated 15, 1 hour and 29 minutes. A man can't speak to ladies. His friend makes things happen. But with two man-killing sisters looking for a virgin man to sacrifice to bring daddy back from the dead. That's really bad, isn't it?
It's a spoiler, I think. I think they shouldn't have put that in the synopsis. I think they should have...
His friends make things happen, but with two man-killing sisters looking for a virgin man to sacrifice to bring daddy back from the dead. That's awful.
Yeah. I would better describe this as the 40-year-old virgin meets, Doghouse or something like that, you know? It's with a very British twist.
And the front cover picture doesn't give it justice. You've got their three heads in boxes, kind of at the bottom, like their heads have been cut off or something. It doesn't... It's a shame, because that synopsis is awful, because this movie is so much better than that synopsis gives it.
So, I'd never seen this before, but I'll let you shoot.
I was off to Fright Fest one year, and my pal messaged me and said, I've got a friend I went to college with, he went to university with him, and he's in a movie called Double Date. And I just went, oh, okay, cool. It's like, sometimes your friends say that. Shout out to Tim, if you're listening. Sometimes your friend will say that, so you go, okay, cool. So you don't think it's, like, possibly the main actor in a movie as good as that. Do you know what I mean? And not, do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
I didn't think it was going to be the main actor in the movie that won the best movie at Fright Fest that year, is what I'm saying. And it was. And I then just kind of, after Fright Fest, kind of forgot about it a little bit. And then I saw it on Amazon and I was like, sweet, Sarah, do you want to check this out? I'll rent it or whatever. And really enjoyed it. And went, that's actually really good. Like, they've got the horror and the comedy down, and it's really, it's like coming after things like Shaun the Dead in that category of well-made film. Not as good as that, obviously, but it's going that way, absolutely. What do you think?
So, Double Date doesn't sound like a horror movie. It sounds like a Ryan Gosling sort of romantic comedy. So I went into this not really knowing what it was about other than the synopsis. There's no trivia on IMDb. You know, it's fairly low-key. It's British. I recognise one of the guys in it, the tall guy, the cool one. So I went into this thinking, well, I don't know what this is about. Alice ended up watching about 80% of it with me. She absolutely loved what she saw. I really, really, really loved this film. I was blown away by it, actually. Gave it like an 8.5 out of 10. So jumping ahead to my score, I am going to be completely gushing over this film. So as I always say, when I've never seen it and you tell me to watch a film, thank you. It's a brilliant film. I thought what I loved about it before we get into it properly is a couple of things. I love that it's a real flip. You had Final Guys, which it's been done before, but
I don't even
the way it's done in this, especially what I would say, and I'll put my neck on the line, says one of the best fight scenes I've seen in a long time.
Fucking well brutal and choreographed.
It's brutal.
It's so tight. Like, so good.
It's like The Raid or Nobody, that movie we talked about in the
you
intro.
You really don't think it's going to be like that. You think it's going to be just a little bit and that's it. And it's just like, that is just full on. They look like they're actually giving themselves a bit of pain.
And it's a guy fighting a girl and she's little and he's big.
And he obviously says, don't do this, don't do it. And it's really well acted as well. It's just that's pretty good.
We'll talk about that scene when we come to it.
I give it a 7 out of 10 to just let you know. I don't think it's as good as 8.5. 8.5 for me is like some top tier things.
I'm sure,
but it's
I'm
a very,
sure
very good
calm
film.
Down.
I think you've got a high pied head when I watched it last time, but I just didn't IMDb it at the time, rate it. I would say 7. I'm happy to say 7. It's a movie. If you said to me, do you want to watch Double Date? Yeah. I would happily go back to it. You know.
So I love the flip of the role reversals, the sexes. I also love that fight. I also love how genuinely funny it was. I felt like it was as funny at times as the Dawn of the Dead. I thought some of the scenes, they just felt so natural with each other, as natural as Nick Frost and Simon Pegg. Really funny stuff. We'll get to those scenes, you know, like the stuff when they take pills and stuff like that. Really funny, really genuine moments. And because it was so funny, when there were brutal moments, it really pulled my emotions, you know, particularly towards the end. And then you throw in all the weird Texas Chainsaw Massacre vibes at the end, and you're like, wow, I didn't see that coming. Like, wow, okay.
I think best way to say it is just it's very, very, very well produced, and using that word produced as an umbrella for every element in the film. It's well directed. It's
very
well
acted.
The score by Goat, who I don't know of.
Yes. Oh my God, that score.
The music
in
it is really good. The songs in it, the credit sequence songs, the credit sequence, the comic redness of that, that's really good. Everything in this movie is really good. The idea is good. The story is good. It's, you know, I don't want to say film gods because that might be giving it maybe more than it deserves, but every element in it is pretty fucking good. So umbrella in it, it's a very well produced film.
So Benjamin Benjamin Barfoot is the director, and I just want to see what else he's done. So he literally this is his first movie.
Yeah.
He did some short films. And then he did this, and then he's directed a few series of Panorama documentary. That's all he's done so far.
So I wonder what he's going to make next. You know,
who knows,
he going to work with the? Is he? Well, thing is though, Danny's written this for him, like the main actor, Danny Morgan. He's written this for him to be the star in. And you know, I had problems with that with the Wolf of Snow Legend or whatever it's called, the Snow Legend Wolf. I think with the Jim Cummings doing that,
the Snow Wolf Legend, whatever it's called. Yep.
I had problems with Jim Cummings doing that because I just didn't think it worked. But this dude, I'm not saying that. I think if I was to put a load of blokes in a lineup and say which one looks like this, they're still a virgin, say it's him. But he can play this character. That's not saying anything negative towards the person at all. He can play this character, and he plays it very well, and he knows this because he's written it. So I'm presuming there is something in his life where he had this. Now, funny enough, Dan, this kind of reminds me of me, but with kissing. His mate's like, I don't fucking understand it, mate. You've put this whole sex thing on a mountain. I'll tell you what, I'll be a Sherpa, or I'll go there with you. And he says that stuff, and it's really lovely little chat. But I had this with kissing, because I didn't kiss a girl to her. I don't know what turn the world is. I think because a girl to was like 18 and a half. And I had loads of opportunities.
And a half.
I know. I remember specifically because at 19 I got laid. So, you know. So, yeah, I had this whole thing with kissing because I was just out skateboarding and stuff to the point where I went to a party and there was a girl. They're like, oh, go in there, Kelly, go in there. I won't say her full name. And come and sit with me. And they all sat there through the kitchen work bit, you know, the kitchen bit where you give food through, all of them at the party, yeah. Watched to see if she'd get off me. And she was sat there like, and I just left and went home. I didn't want to do it. I didn't find her attractive, to be honest with you. That's why I didn't want to do it. But so I had this thing. So I'm watching this movie going, I kind of relate to this dude. I get this thing of putting something on a pedestal, like, it's the other sex, oh my god, this is so hard, how do you talk to them, how do you do this, I don't know what to do. And it's taken a while to figure out how to know what to do, do you know what I mean? But so I understand this, and I think there's going to be many men out there who would watch this and go, yep, I can relate to that, do you know what I mean? So I think it's a great story, great idea.
I really love the two guys in this, and I really love their camaraderie they've got there.
See, these two brilliantly cast this movie, not like Night of the Creeps. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, but I know what you mean. And I think that there's like a genuine bromance between them. They do something which is really honourable at one point during the film to the girls, but we know that the girls are even more horrible than them. So.
Only one of them did, though.
Only Alex does it.
And
but,
I know what you mean as well. And I love the reaction of the bad girl who then realises, and she's just like, he's playing on the same level. I love that. We'll get to it. Yeah. If you haven't seen this film, if you've not seen this film, go watch it, because I think us reviewing it will take away some of the real fun in it. There's some really good physical gags and jokes and things. So, yeah.
So we start off confusingly in a speeding car. Looks like some people are burning along in a Jaguar, and they're playing music really loud, and they're going to a mansion for a party. It's two guys and two girls, so we know what's going down here. It turns out it's the girls' home, and the guy's like, oh my God, you've got pillars in your house, like, you must be rich. Like, one of them says, I thought only the Romans had pillars. And they're being all sort of drunk and ridiculous. Two of them go upstairs. The taller of the two brunettes, who we find out later are sisters, she goes upstairs with the guy, and she puts on her song, which is, we'll always be together, together in electric dreams. I think that's the song. And that's the song she plays whenever she's about to kill someone in the bedroom, because that's what she's about to do. So they start kissing, and at least kissing her, her wig comes off because she's got like longer hair. And she, out of nowhere, this goes from what was going to be a sex scene to, she just stabs him about 50 times, like brutally punctures his torso.
Yeah, the horror in this is like, yeah, the way that she's sort of stabbing him, it's like, what the fuck? This is like a true crime serial killer type. And it's like with passion killing. Do you know what I mean? It's
like
full
in
anger.
Bronson or
yeah, real and proper violent. Like, it's, the camera just sits there. You're like, oh my God, wasn't expecting such brutality with the knife.
So she comes downstairs and she says, you promised it would be quick and painless. And she says to her little sister, have you done yours yet? Meaning, have you killed yours yet?
Yeah.
Which she hasn't. And we get the titles. And it's a cartoon. It's done in a weird style, but I'm into this. We've got that great song by Goat.
Yeah, the music in this is really nice. It's got a real It's got a real pie vibe to horror. It makes you feel like you're there and you're a bit drunk with them. Because this movie's a real, real drunken bar movie. There's a lot of scenes in pubs and going places, getting wasted in clubs and bars, and drugs. Drugs are in
this as well.
Yeah, I don't really know the guy. He's a UK grime artist, right?
Yeah, he's in it. That scene with him and then Goat coming on stage, really, like you said, you really feel like you're a bit.
You kind of go there. They really get the party scene quite well. Yeah, it's a well-made movie.
Should imagine these guys have all perhaps tried party disco biscuits just to sort of...
Absolutely. You know. But this is now where we get to the fun of the film. We get to our main characters, which are brilliant. We've got Danny, the main guy. He's a red-headed gentleman.
Jim, but Danny plays
Jim.
Jim.
And we got his mate, Alex, who's not really with him. Jim seems to be there to meet his girlfriend that he thinks is his girlfriend, and so his mate Alex sort of pops over and says, "Hey, what are you doing?" It's kind of like this bar seems to kind of be like the Winchester in the Shaun of the Dead, because we go back there a couple of times to the point where the barmaid says, "Look, you're gonna behave yourself tonight," to one of them, so we know it's a regular spot. Alex is your kind of like your more charity shop kind of Donnie Darko type character, isn't he? Donnie Darko.
Jake Gyllenhaal.
Jake Gyllenhaal. He's very much like a Jake Gyllenhaal. He's great. I think he looks really good, and his performance is really good. He plays the character that he's playing to a T. He's probably had sex with every person in that pub.
He is a really good-looking, tall, handsome guy. Got the mouth, like he can really talk his way out of any situation he's a bit of a salt of the earth as well, as people would say. He's because of his accent, because he's got this like localized accent. I can't quite place where it's from. It's like northern England. You really like believe every word he says. You know, when he's later on when he's helping Jim get ready, he's like, "Look, you got beautiful ginger bollocks. You have, come on, any girl would be." And he's really being really sweet to him. And I don't know, there's just something endearing about him. Although he does that thing later on, which we'll talk about, but we'll get to that. Yeah, but and then it all comes out that she's dumping him by text.
Well, I think Alex just wants to have sex with as many women as he possibly can. That he's it. I've known of that guys like this. So he's just like he's just like his mate Jim, who's about to turn 30, by the way, and hasn't lost his virginity. And Alex is like, look, this is my aim for you. I will get this done for you. That's basically the sort of. It's quite nice. You've got two stories parallel here. The aim for him is we'll get you laid. That could be a story in itself, just that, and you can have a comedy drama of two mates. The other side is you got these two killers that need this victim who happens to be a virgin. Is it a virgin? Yep. Do they need a virgin?
Brilliant. Yeah, they do need a virgin, yeah.
So that means one of those guys from before was a virgin as well.
So Alex... Yeah, that's true. So Alex realises that Jim is a virgin at 29, but he doesn't tell anyone, but he says that thing that you said about, you know, why have you got... You've made a massive mountain out of sex. Like, it's not that hard, honestly.
And that's what people once you've done it, do with it, though, don't they? That's what I sort of kind of understood
anxiety,
from the kissing thing I had. Yeah, totally.
So he makes a vow. He says, "I will get you laid before your 30th birthday," which is literally the next day.
Yeah, he's like, "Right, we need to go on it now." And it's I do like the way what he thinks you should do to talk to a woman. Just later on when he says like the whole. Smashing the ice and breaking the ice is fucking brilliant. But we get to that bit.
Well, imagine Alex going out with JC from Night of the Creeps. So that would be a fun night, because those two are like very quick. You know, they would be chatting away to each other. It'd be fun. But he sees a girl on the other side of the bar and he says to Jim, "Right, there you go. We're going to start off with
her." It's the same thing in the same movie, isn't it? The same two characters in the bar at the beginning of the other movie with the other guy saying, "Just go and talk to her." Like, it's the same thing.
It is like that. And he goes up to her, and Alex goes up and he starts speaking to her, and then he comes back over and he says to Jim, "Oh, I've got a crier." And he's like, what do you mean? He said, oh, I started talking to her and she started talking about her dead husband. She's a widow.
Oh, God, this bit.
And then just when you think, oh, well, that's bad, he says, well, she's coming over now anyway. So then she comes. So he still invites her over, even though she's a widow. And he leaves Jim with
she's basically the
bar to talk to her.
Basically, this woman's drunk by herself at the bar. And his mate, I want to say Jake then.
Jim, she says...
No, we've got to remember, picture this scene. She's drunk at the bar. Alex has gone over as like a leopard and his prey. He thinks, oh, brilliant. And then he goes, oh, I've got a crier. So he's figured out, oh, brilliant, I can put a panner on to Jim. All right, and just go over to Jim. So she's coming over. When she comes over, he goes, right, I'll leave you lovebirds alone, and just walks off. And Jim just doesn't know how to speak to women. So he's got the upper advantage that she's really drunk. But the fact that she's crying her eyes out, saying, am I sexy? Would you have sex with me?
I miss my husband.
Like, and he's, but Jim's a nice guy. He's not going to take advantage of it. What ends up with Jim, though, is hilarious from this.
Well, he gets her a taxi, and then he ends up having to get in the taxi with her.
He goes with her because he can't leave her like that because he's an all right guy. So then he's decided he's gone.
The taxi driver says, if she throws up in here, you're cleaning it up. So she throws up in her handbag, and then he's got to go through her handbag to try and find her keys and her address.
Yeah.
They finally get to her house. And I don't know who's called the police. But there's one point where he's like pulling her up the stairs, trying to get her.
It would be someone outside just seeing that, or even the taxi driver just ring up, please. So this woman's really drunk, and he's just taken her home. It's so funny. He just looks around and says, "Spotted them. I'm with them now." Like, that's all we need, because the audience isn't stupid. So that's all you need, and we know what's going on.
And he does actually go to the police station and he gets to spend the night in a cell. But in the morning, the woman's like said, oh, no, I was just really drunk and he actually was genuinely helping me home. So that's all kind of cleared up. And that's kind of that.
It is pretty funny, though.
It is. It's hilarious. We see a bit more of this mansion with these two girls who are using blood to paint out some kind of ritualistic symbols on the floor. We don't know much more other than it's the two girls from the beginning. And then we cut back to this pub where everyone hangs out and we meet Laura, who's a drug dealer.
Before though, I do like when the copper says to Jim in the mornings, just stick to more sober women in the future, yeah? And Jim just awkwardly doesn't want to have to go into it and say, yeah, okay, yeah. Because he's so innocent in that. Yeah, okay. But yeah, they're back at this pub again, the local, but it's in the daytime. It's maybe having a cup of coffee or whatever. They must be there all the time. That's why I say it's like the Winchester. And they've got their friend with them as well, who comes over. With
Laura, the drug dealer.
With her boyfriend's band, Crabs.
Oh, God. Crabs.
Crabs.
Crabs. It's pronounced Crabs.
It's so funny, really though. This band, man. I've been in London. I've been at the odd gig before where it's like two people at keyboards. And loads of these twats around me just, yeah. And it's like, oh man, what is this pretentious shit? I've literally been at those gigs and I knew this one. It's so funny. It's not a commentary on it. It's just taking the piss out of it. Because you could throw some money and be like, I bet there's a bar in there. There's also some open room with two people behind keyboards and 15 of their mates watching.
Yeah. You know. It's always their mates and their mum in the corner.
Yeah.
Well, in the bar walk our two sexy, hot, dangerous women from the beginning.
Oh, sorry. I was jumping ahead then about when they go later on to the bar. Oh, Crabs. Yeah, I was talking about the Crabs bar with the band. Sorry, I do apologize. We're back now, ladies and gentlemen, with our two characters, with the guy who needs to lose his virginity and his friend who's going to help him. And what happens, Dan?
So the two hot killers walk in and Alex says, look, go up there,
but they,
order
not
a drink
just,
with ice
not
in
just,
it.
Not just they come in and they look at Jim and they stare at Jim to the point when, like, the camera catches, if you look at the two women, to the left and right of you, you've got layers of men coming back through the how far away they are to where Jim is, all looking at Jim and turning their head to Jim going, why are they looking at Jim? Or why are they looking at this character? And it's so fun. Yep. It's just a real subtle comedy in this movie. It's really good, the humour. It's brilliant.
But they hone in on him and they stare at him.
And he's just like, oh my God, they're looking at me. They're looking at me. They're looking at me. And like Alex and the other lady that comes in, their friend, not Lulu, one of them.
Laura.
They're just like, whoa, here's your chance, mate. Here's your chance. And just don't, Laura's just like, oh, I feel sick. When Alex starts trying to say ways to go up to these women and say stuff to them. And it's just like, he goes up to them, look, basically get an ice cube, smash the ice, and say, now smash the ice, ladies, what can I get you for a drink?
Now I've broken the ice.
I'm doing the gag. Jim says smash the ice. Yeah. You can notice I did really well with women as well.
So he does do this. Eventually he goes up, he orders a drink. He can't get the ice cubes out. One of them hits the hot girl in the head when he smashes it with his fist.
Right, he just fumbles with his drink of lemonade. He asks for a glass of lemonade and fumbles around with him. Hits the ice cube out. Hits it down. It chips off into her forehead. She's like, ow! And he's like, oh, sorry. Looks back at the drink and says, now smash the ice.
When it doesn't get any worse then, he's trying to then get some words out. And she says, is your hand bleeding? And he's cut his hand on the ice.
Yeah, is your hand? Oh, no, it's okay. Then he's like, now smash the ice. And then just stands there. Then he says, I watch people.
because Alex said to him, tell him you're a spy. Yeah. Tell him fucking anything you want. You just tell him anything tonight. So he says, I watch people. No, I don't watch people. That sounds wrong. I spy on people.
He's hit her with an ice cube. Said, now smash the ice. I spy on people. It's just like, oh my God, this could not get any worse. But then Alex starts still keen though.
And they're just like,
this is even brilliant. Go on, you do it.
He's sort of saying things like, ask them this, tell them that. And then he says to her, now walk away. And then he realizes that was an instruction to him, not for him to say it out.
He reads it out and just walks off. Do you fancy a fuck time in lotion? I mean, a fun time in London. But they all go, yeah, all right. And he's like, oh. And he says, walk away. And goes, walk away. And looks at them.
So he goes back to the table and he sits down and he can't believe.
Yeah, can't believe it. We're going to date and he's, Alex is like, fuck yeah, well done.
So we get a really sweet scene now where Alex knocks on the door and Jim is lying on his bed in his pants and he says, I don't want to go out.
This is really sweet. He says, what the fuck are you doing, mate? You know, in a real you don't expect your mate, when you're about to go to the pub on a Friday night or whatever, your mate's there in his pants doing a puzzle T-Rex. T-Rex. I've almost finished it. And it's real childlike, like he's 15 again or something.
He's a bit depressed, isn't he? And he doesn't want to go out. I'm going to pull you out of this.
Well, no, it's because he's scared. He's worried about losing virginity. He just doesn't think he can. He's made it like a massive thing, which people do this,
But he gives him this pep talk. He helps him pick out an outfit. There's one point where he says some of the outfits, the things he describes what he looks like, are hilarious. He's like, you look like a pedo geography teacher or something like that in one of them. And he keeps us, no, take that one off, no, put that one on. And then he said, oh, what about these trousers? They're my work trousers. Yeah, and they show off your arse nice. And he gives him a big slap on the arse and he helps him pick out a nice outfit. And he tells him that, we're going to do this. We're going to go out. We're going to have a bloody good night tonight. It's all good. Don't worry about it. Now, meanwhile, while they're getting ready, the girls are getting ready because our main girl, Kitty, who's the older of the two sisters, she must be an MMA fighter or a kickboxer in real life. She is kicking the absolute living shit out of this mannequin to the point the final move she does on it is she kicks its head right off. She is insane. Yeah. And these are real moves as well. Like I've been kickboxing for years. I can tell that she's really trained. Like she's in ridiculous. Like she's now sexy and scary from this scene. I'm now a little bit scared of her, which makes her even sexier.
Yeah. She is an attractive lady. We do realise, we come to find out now, their mission, their objective in all of this as well, is that they want to try and bring back their father. It's a bit old Texas Chainsaw Massacre, isn't it? It's like, let's get Grandpa down here to hit the head of the woman. It's later on. But yeah, they could try and bring their father back, who's died. You know.
Well, Kitty says to her younger sister Lulu, "Come on, it'll be fun. We've got to kill these two guys. Daddy will be so happy when he sees how much you've grown." And you think, what is the relationship here? I don't understand. And they do more blood painting, more rituals. They've got matching tattoos as well. And they get ready for their going out at the same time as we see the...
I love the juxtaposition montage where we got Jim and Alex just getting ready, doing their fucking shaving, doing their hair and whatever they're doing. And then we've obviously got these two doing the same thing, but they're getting all their weapons ready and getting everything they need to do, like getting the syringe ready and all these different things,
chloroform,
and it's going back and forwards. It's really nice done over really good music again by Goat. It's just like, this is really cool. I love that juxtaposition. It's obviously what it would happen. It'd be easy to write that, go, okay, well then that's going to happen, but it just looks really nice, put them both together.
Yeah, and it's just slick yeah, all the way through.
World Cup.
They meet at the bar, and Jim again starts making awkward conversation. They realise that the girls don't drink.
Yeah, well, Kitty's a woman of my own heart. Cranberry juice. She wants some cranberry juice, and Alex is just like, uh-oh, we've got a problem. Takes Jim to the toilet and says, look, no offence, mate.
In front of everybody.
No offence, mate, but if no one's going to fuck you sober. Oh, thanks very much. He goes, well, it's truth. And he's a bastard. Of course a lady's going to have sex with him sober. I'm sure.
But all the blokes in the toilet, obviously, because they say this really loud, all look around, and none of them sort of, they all go, They will look at Jim and go, yeah, he's probably right.
he feels sorry for him. What the fuck? What's his plan? Hashtag me too. Well,
he says, shit, what we're going to need to do is we're going to go and see our mate Laura, whose boyfriend Krobs is playing in that little bar.
Krobs.
Get some pills off of her, and we'll probably do a Bill Cosby on these two.
We'll do some Cosbys on them.
Yeah, so they take a pill each, but also they crush up some and put it in their cranberry juice, which they don't drink because it gets smashed on the floor, because Jim realises what's happening and he stops it by smashing the drinks on the floor. However, him and Alex have still taken pills, which comes back later on for
in
some
hilarious
fun.
Ways.
In hilarious, hilarious, and very realistic, very well acted, realistic ways as well. Some funny stuff goes on with that. So, they go to the club where Big Nasty's playing, loads of dubstep. Jim gets a text from his mum, which is great, reminding him that he has to go. Is it his birthday party?
It's his 30th.
Yeah, of course it is. It's his 30th, yeah.
I really like the pairing of these two as well, because Alex and Kitty are both very like proactive people, really, aren't they? Really like strong-willed people. And the other two are quite both like, they both got this little thing to do and they're both scared it's their first time sort of thing. I love the fact the conversation Jim has, though, when he says, cranberry juice, I heard it's good for period pains. What are you doing? What are you talking about, period pains? He went, I don't know. So why? Because he doesn't know what to say, so he's just like, cranberry juice. Cranberry juice, I hear, is good for period pains. And he just keeps doing stuff like that, and it's just not... the humour's just really well done. It's not forceful in any way, and it's very well thought out and natural.
And it's not going well, and he's more than happy when he receives the text from his mum to say, I've got to go. But Lulu does say, well, I'll go with you.
Before
I'll drive you there.
You said about the knocking of the pill out there. Drinks, did you? Because they've already pilled. Yeah. I do love that bit, like I said earlier on, where Kitty just looks down, then looks in her drink, and just her mouth opens up like... when she realises that what Alex is doing, and she does kind of realise he's on the same level, because later on they have this fight, and they are both pretty equal matched in that sense as well. So I do like the fact she's like, oh, I've got a fucking challenge on my hands, and this isn't going to be easy as I thought it was going to be. You know, because if they'd have got drugs, that'd been the game over. Like, you know.
Yeah.
But anyway, these two have taken them, though.
Well, Lulu drives Jim back to his mum and dad's, and when he arrives there, they've got a cake with his face on it.
Mum, dad, and his sister. His sister must be like 35, 36, I guess. And they've all got their normal clothes, but they've got white T-shirts over the top. And imagine what it's like when you wear a T-shirt over the top of a shirt and jump. It's just really random. And it's only for certain reasons you're going to do it, charity events or stuff. They've got T-shirts of his mug of when he was a kid, his face all over the T-shirts, and they're all wearing them. And he's turned up with this girl he's hoping to lose his virginity with. And it's like, oh my God, like, you know.
Now she's meeting his entire family.
And they are nerds.
And they say, do you want a T-shirt? We've got one where the printing went a bit wrong.
I love the way this is shot as well, because as he slowly starts to come up on his pill, it's like it closes in to the wide lens, it closes into the mum and dad and stuff, and dad starts stuttering more. And it's just like creepy and weird. Yeah. And his eyes get bigger at one point. It's a bit fear and loathing in Las Vegas.
And because they're such a funny, unique little family, they do a birthday song that they've written over the years.
And the spare T-shirt they got for the girl, Lulu, is a misprint. So it's all fucked. So his face is all... It looks like what he's imagining possibly looking at anyway, if he's tripping or something. I know he's not tripping, he's pilling. But so they do that. Let's do the family song.
Dad plays the air guitar, mum's in the kitchen, and it's like, what
Daddy
is going on?
Daddy plays air guitar, bow, 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 bum, mummy's in the kitchen, da-da-da. And it's like, oh my God, what is going on?
And then the last bit
is falling
nanny,
for him.
Hang on, the last bit, though, is they go, and grandma, and they will just look at the picture, because grandma must have died like the year before, and they will just stare at the picture for a split second and feel a bit sad.
Yeah.
Jim's made to
join in with him, so he's joining in. Lulu's starting to like him, though. She's just the music all cuts out and it's closing on her face, and she's looking at him, and it's all muted. So we're realizing that she likes him. But then it finishes. Then Jim just breaks into a track, doesn't he?
He breaks into not quite beatboxing, but drumming,
just dancing. And they all
do
it. His mum and dad are like, okay, let's go along with it, because they're so innocent, bless them. And they start trying to go along with it. And mum's going, oh, this is, oh my God. Then they, I love it when they cut back to him later on and he's just handshaking in the air, just really going for it, but there's no music. And they're all just staring at him, going, is he all right?
His dad looks at the picture of Jesus and he says, I think he's fine, God.
He's been touched by Jesus. Oh my God, you innocent people.
Oh, and Lulu's just sat watching this whole thing unfold.
Going like,
I was crying. I was crying with this scene, with laughter.
It was so funny.
It was really funny. And he sits back down and they give him a pen knife. This was your grandma's pen knife.
We know that's coming into play later.
Yeah, definitely. So back in the club, Alex loses Kitty and he finds her dry humping some guy on the dance floor, and he's really pissed off. So he throws a drink at her and storms off to dance on his own on the podium on his pills.
Yeah, because she says, what are you doing? Because she starts dancing with some random guy. And he said, what are you doing? She goes, I'm not interested in you. And she says, fuck off, all right? And, yeah, because she's got those two together now. She's got her plan in motion. Yeah. But he's pinning, he wants to go dancing.
So she goes into the toilets and knock on the door. It's a bouncer. And he says, oi, we don't allow drugs in this club. And she says, I'm not doing any. And he goes, open the door now. So she he bursts in and starts to sort of... She says, look, I'll make it worth your while, and sort of implies she might give this bouncer a blowjob. She ends up just slitting his throat, doesn't she?
Mm-hmm.
It's a pretty nice effect, actually.
Jim's slapped by Lulu, says, come on, let's get back to club. And Jim's like, club, dancing, let me get there. And
yes.
Talks at a million miles an hour while she drives.
Kitty... Oh, yeah, she hunts down Alex. She's got a syringe and she's trying to find him in the club. He's off his nut on the podium at this point. You see him just literally sweating.
He's happy as anything, though, isn't he?
He's going for it. He's absolutely going for it. And my favourite bit is in a minute. So Lulu Lulu stops her just as she's about to go over and inject him. And Jim, they try and take Jim away before Alex spots him. And Jim goes, no, I need to see him. Because they're both on the same level.
Oh, yeah.
And
yeah.
as soon as they see each other, they just run towards each other.
Hugging like, each other.
I love you. I love you. And it's just so, like, I've seen this happen so many times. Yeah, it's so yeah. funny. Like, yeah. these guys are on the same level. It's so, and then they're back in the Jag. And my notes say they are so high in the back of the Jag. They're holding hands. I never want to let go of your hand. You don't have to, Jim. You don't ever have to let go. Do the beatboxing, Jim. And he starts beatboxing for the girls. And they're just like, and they're speeding along in this Jaguar at 80 miles an hour back to the mansion. It's just insane.
I've been that person driving them sober as fuck going, oh, God, just get out of my car.
And they find a joint under the seat.
Yeah, just a pretty big joint which hasn't snapped
very
at all.
Long
it's,
one.
It's amazing how they just found that, but yeah.
They light that up, but that makes them crash the car. And into a tree. Lulu's breaks her nose, or thinks she's broken her nose. There's a lot of blood coming out of her nose. It turns out the car wasn't actually theirs. It was their uncle's that they stole. He's in prison. So they stole their prisoner uncle's Jaguar, which is why there was like a dildo and a gun in the glove box. Apparently he was a bit of a dodgy character.
Yeah, supposedly.
I always keep a dildo in my Jaguar's glove box.
Yeah, you never know.
You never know. Jim's ex texts him saying, I'll be round soon, get the lube out. And he thinks, oh, wow, she wants me back. And then he says, gets another text straight away going, really sorry, that wasn't meant for you. That was meant for somebody else.
Got it.
Oh, on his 30th birthday, almost his 30th birthday as well. Oh, Jim, you poor bastard. You poor bastard. He tries to kiss Lulu. That doesn't really work out. Alex realizes, lo and behold, my dad lives near here in a caravan. We can walk there in about an hour from here. He'll be able to help us. He'll lend us his car.
That's Dexter Fletcher. So
it's Dexter. So they all head over there. And he lives in a trailer.
There's a lady who comes out who's his cleaner. So she does a really bad job because the caravan's still really messy.
Yeah, she's definitely a prostitute.
Sex worker, Dan.
Sex worker. The girls are preparing to make their move. But Lulu does say to Kitty, look, I really want to let these guys go. I don't want to do it with these guys. But the boys are chatting to Dexter, trying to like sort of say, Dad, can I borrow that car? Come on.
We need your car, Dad.
He's a really lovely dad as well, even though he's shagging prostitutes. He's a really lovely dad.
He's off his face, though, as well.
He is. He's really shunk. And while the boys are outside sorting out the car, there's some footage on TV, CCTV footage of the two girls that have been dubbed by the media the Man-Eaters. And it's obviously Kitty and Lulu. Dex sees this. He sees this.
Yeah.
And they attack him. They smash a lamp over his head. They don't actually kill him. They just knock him out so badly. He does try and fight back, but they end up chloroforming him. And the boys go back in and they go, his dad's passed out. And he's like, oh, yeah, he does that every time. Don't worry about it.
Yeah.
It's fine.
And it looks like he is passed out, though, so they've kind of got away with it. I thought they'd actually killed him, but they didn't actually kill him.
There's a really sweet moment where they're about to leave and Alex goes, give me a second. And he goes back inside and he sits down next to his dad, puts his hand on him and gives him a kiss and goes, love you, Dad.
Yeah.
It's just no reason. I just love it.
And Jim had gone to the shop to just get stuff and he didn't know what to buy. I love that bit. And he looks and he's got Bombay Mix. Why have you bought Bombay Mix? And it's just because he's like, I didn't know what to buy. He's like, oh, God, poor lad. I just don't know what to do with this whole situation with these ladies.
So they get in Jim's dad's car and they realise they've got 4 hours until he turns 30. Because he says, when were you born? He says, 4 a.m. He says, right, we've got 4 hours then to get you laid. So, again, on the news, we hear more on the car radio about a dead bouncer. Again, they think police think this is linked to the man-eaters.
The way they're saying it, and they're all listening to it, and they're all kind of going, Jim just looks nervously at Lily, and just smiles.
They arrive at the mansion. Kitty and Alex go upstairs. So this is the opening scene replayed, but with a different man. She puts on that song, Electric Dreams, and we know what she's planning on doing to Alex. And we all think Alex is a goner.
Yeah.
You know, but he turns around and sees her holding a knife, and she says, sorry about this, expecting to just be able to take him out. But he actually fights back. He really pushes her back. Now, she's got MMA skills, so she gives him a couple of kicks and punches.
He realizes, oh, shit. So he has to, like, step it up a gear, even though he doesn't want to.
Because she's a woman. He thinks, this is bad. I don't really want to hit you. But in the end, he realizes, well, it's me or her. So he starts sort of strangling her, and he's a bit upset with himself. You can see his acting. It's amazing.
Is it sexist to say that he shouldn't hit a woman? Because it's just a person.
Oh, he should. I would say he should definitely have hit this woman. She was trying to stab him. Absolutely.
She's pretty full on, yeah.
She smashes a bottle over his head. He keeps saying to her, give me a fucking breather. Let me just catch my breath.
It's such a well-made fight. The whole thing, shot, done. We talked about it earlier, but it's really good. Really violent.
Yeah, it goes on for a while. She chokes him. She uses her MMA skills. Alex, he really tries to fight back. He does throw her against the wall, because he is bigger. And at one point, he says to her, look, for fuck's sake, stay down. I don't want to hurt you. I'm a fucking bloke. I can kill you if I want, and I don't want to hurt you. But she keeps getting up and getting up, and he throws her against the wall. He really goes for it at one point, and then
but she's giving it back just as much though.
Oh, absolutely. There's one point then where she grabs his bollocks and they start kissing, and you think, oh, this might turn into a sex scene.
She's being sneaky though, isn't she?
Yeah, because she really squeezes hold on his nuts, and he pulls a shelf down off the wall, smashes it onto her, and just when you think that's
the Terminator,
he jumps on top of the shelf about five times just to crush her, and he falls down and he goes, fucking hell, I was not expecting that tonight. And he kind of leans back against the wall and starts passing out. And yeah, she's the Terminator, because she just bursts out of the back of the shelving unit. All her clothes have gone off. She's just in her underwear, like, rawr! And you're like, this woman is terrifying.
Yeah, she at this point, you're like, oh my God. And he just doesn't want this either, though.
It's so, so good. And again, I said this earlier, and I haven't done it justice with that description, but this is one of the best fights I've seen on screen in a long time. Because it's between a man and a woman, and I've never seen anything like that before. You know, I'm not condoning men hitting women or women hitting men, but this is a film. This is fantasy. And these are two people trying to kill each other. It's fucking brutal and so well shot. It's amazing. Yeah. Absolutely love it.
Agree.
Lulu wants Jim to run away downstairs, so he says, run, run, run. So as he goes to run, he's bong, hit in the face with a shovel by Kitty. So he's knocked out. And this is where he wakes up, Gav, doesn't he, Jim? Old Jimmy boy. And he's tied in a wheelchair. And you hear Kitty saying, Daddy's waiting. And you think, well, where's this going?
Yeah.
And then he spots there's like five other bodies around him in wheelchairs, all placed in like a pentagram circle.
Yeah, with bags on their faces. It's really creepy. All of a sudden, we're in the House of the Devil territory. This is like proper like creepy horror. Like, oh man, that looks, yeah, quite horrific, really. Creepy.
Yeah, because it's gone from almost serial killer, sort of American Psycho style to Texas Chainsaw, sort of weird. I don't know. You don't know where it's going to go next, really. Are they vampires? What is this? What's going on, you know? They start doing this chanting and doing this ritual, and Daddy does wake up a little bit. And while that's happening, Jim remembers he's got Grandma's penknife, which is always handy.
Yeah.
Daddy says, drain the virgin. And they're like, yes, drain the virgin, drain him. And he thinks, fucking hell, they're going to drain me. Like, Jesus Christ. So he gets his...
gets his what?
his penknife out.
Yep.
What do you think I said?
You broke up on the internet.
Oh, so sorry. He gets his penis out. I thought you thought I said.
I'd imagine that was what's coming out of your mouth.
Lulu starts actually fighting Kitty. Alex turns up, but he's no use because he just collapses. He's absolutely had the shit kicked out of him. But he's there in spirit, just lying on the floor.
Yeah.
Jim snaps Dad's hand off because he's like so old and dead that his body parts just seem to snap off.
Yeah.
He stabs him in the head, and then doesn't he kick his head off at one point?
Yeah. Yeah.
Kitty's pissed off. She throws a knife at Jim. Lulu hits Kitty with a shovel, so the sisters really face off, and it ends up with her getting killed. And then Jim says, "I'm really sorry I kicked Dad's head off." And then they kind of look at each other lovingly, but then the police turn up, sirens wailing, and it's quite a realistic ending because Lulu, he says to Lulu, "Go on, off you go, and go and run away." But she does get arrested, and the boys end up like having to get on their hands and knees as well because the police don't just like let them off. They're suspicious of anybody, you know. There's loads of dead bodies in this mansion.
Yeah.
And she's arrested, and that's kind of the end of the film. Really, it ends quite abruptly, but it's still a satisfying ending.
Still didn't lose his virginity.
He didn't.
Nope. He did not succeed in goal.
But this was a wild ride, and it was so funny, but also so brutal and so original and so slick and well produced all the way through. And I had an absolute blast with this, and I really look forward to watching it again at some point.
I've been waiting and waiting until we did this episode to watch it again, and I really enjoyed being able to have that chance. Do check it out, guys, if you haven't seen it already and you just thought, fuck you guys, well, I'm listening to you both anyway, then cool, that's fine, you so be it, you do your thing. Do check it out if you can, though. It is a fun movie, as Dan said. I'm glad you like it.
If you've got Prime, you don't have to pay to rent it or anything. If you're paying for Prime, it's already on there. Yeah. Just watch it. It's an hour and 29 minutes.
You're paying with your time of the existence you have on this planet.
It's really good stuff, though.
Yeah, I'm glad you liked it, Dan. I'm glad I have done well with recommendation for you. I shall try and keep it up.
That's what she said.
Ooh, it is our Valentine's sexy episode. I hope you're all feeling sexy still.
I am.
The whole time you're listening to this, if you're at work, just try to keep the sexiness to yourself. Just in case. You don't want to spread out.
Depends what
much.
You do.
I suppose, yeah.
If you're a vet, yeah, keep the sexiness to yourself. Mm. You're around animals. But if you
work
in the porn industry
a
as a fluffer.
You could be sexy. If you're a train driver and you're just by yourself in the front of the train listening to us, you could be sexy. Sex it out. Sex yourself all over the tracks.
Don't crash the train.
No, but just sexy up it enough so there's no dead bodies from train crashing. Right, anyway.
Oh. Hey, Bill. He's getting excited. He's tapping his glass. Okay. He knows what time it is.
Is it that time?
It's time for Word of the Strange. Bill Murray, please. Let's go.
Hi, welcome back to World of the Strange.
World of the Strange, the sexy strange.
World of the sexy. Sexy.
Sexy and strange. The two are not interchangeable.
Sexy.
Gav, it's our Valentine's special, and I want to talk about dating.
Mm-hmm.
What's the worst date you've ever been on?
Ooh. Very early on, the whole shenanigans of me not being kissing a girl, I was on a date with a girl, kind of, sort of thing, and I was in the road with her, and I went to kiss her, and kissed her nose, and then got really awkward and turned around and walked away, and that was the last time I saw her, I think, actually.
Oh God! She's hit by a car.
She's from Liverpool. No, she wasn't. She's just in my town, and I knew her cousin, and I was just like, "Who's that? I quite like Kitty. I like her." And she's like, "Is she go out of you? Oh, you go out of me, wicked." What, not knowing what that means, anything at all. And yeah, kissed her nose.
Oh.
I nearly kissed a girl at that point, but didn't.
I had a similar experience. It wasn't really a date, but I had an experience
that wasn't
really
with a date,
there was a girl that I was besotted with for about 2 days on holiday, and I'd met her in the bar every night. Hadn't got the courage to kiss her yet. I was probably only about 17, and I had kissed girls, but just I couldn't get myself to kiss this girl for some reason. And then one night, sort of 2 a.m., the club finished, and she agreed to let me walk her back to her, you know, guest house, wherever she was staying. And it was about a 45-minute, an hour walk. It was quite a walk. So I walked her all the way back there, 2 in the morning, got to the door, and I stuck my hand out and shook her hand and said, bye-bye. I don't know why I did that. Why did I shake her hand?
After gentlemanly walking that distance with her, she's letting you walk that distance.
I don't know what I was thinking.
Yeah, but I've done that though. I've been in situations where I could have done things and I just didn't do it.
Well, look, we are where we are now. We're both very happy. So
indeed.
But these people aren't. Let's go through.
I'm sure Sarah's been enjoying listening to the history of me learning to kiss.
Well, this is a list of some people that haven't had very good dates. This is a list of terrible first dates.
My 18th birthday, I've said this before, my 18th birthday, my friend, who's a pretty well-known actor now, was on the microphone saying, "Is anybody going to get off with Gav before he's 18? And
I knew that is as well.
I'm going to remind him one day when I bump into him again.
Please do.
Yeah, I will. Bastard.
Okay. Here is a list of... Some of these are tame. Some of these are gross. First one is, we were waiting for a table at the restaurant. It was a very nice summer evening. So we stood outside. We were having a lovely conversation, waiting by the door with a few other people. Then the waitress opened the door and said, "Oh, your table's ready." When my date lifted up his leg and did a loud fart so loud... Everybody around stopped their conversations and looked at us. He smiled at me and said, "I didn't want that going off while I was inside the restaurant." I turned around, walked back to my car and went home.
As a man of my own fart, I mean heart. That's just genius, really, is it? He's been honest. He's been who he is.
You know,
there's
imagine
not gonna
that.
Be that. I don't know, though. If she was to look at him and then laugh... probably just have a laugh about it. Unless he's got a real fatuous problem.
That's going to work with someone, isn't it?
Unless he's got a real problem with gastritis or something, and he's farting lots, then that's not good.
Mm. Well, let's move on. So, this is another lady. She said, "For our first date, I went over to his place to watch a movie." Ooh, okay, on the sofa.
On the first date?
Yeah. "As we were making out, he reached over and he gave me a wedgie. Not once, but 3 times during the movie." Wow.
Why did he give her a wedgie? What does he think that's going to achieve? How's that given her any sort of sexual foreplay?
"I left before the movie was over."
So let's just say it's a random 90-minute movie. It could be 2 hours. What, are we saying like every 30 minutes he just gave her a wedgie? She'd be like, "Oh, that's funny." Yeah, that's really weird though, isn't it?
It's weird, a wedgie. I once got, I was in a pub once with, you know, Dave, my buddy. Mm-hmm. We were having a drink, we were about 18, and these kids, I say kids, they're about our age, they started to try and start a fight with us. We don't even know who they were. So we left the pub, we didn't really want to fight them, and they came out and they tried to wedgie me. So I punched him in the face, and I don't really hit people, but I punched him in the face, and I said, "What the fuck do you think you're doing? I'm 18. Why are you wedging me? We're not at school." And he's like, looked at me like all shocked, and I thought, if you wedgie a bloke, he's going to probably punch you, you twat. And I just walked off, like, left him, like, I couldn't believe what he was doing.
Amazing.
Did they
come after you?
No. Okay. I went to meet a guy for the first time at his house, first date. We met for coffee. He said, "Come over for coffee." I arrived. I smelled the coffee was in the air. But there was a big pile of toenail clippings on the coffee table. It wasn't a recent clipping either. I could tell it was many, many clippings that had been collected. I turned around and walked straight back out.
Again, it's honesty. I've got to give it to these blokes. They're being honest. They're getting out there their true intentions from the get-go. Here's my pile of toenail clippings. If you like me, you'll stay. Maybe you can add to the pile.
What do you collect? Because I collect my toenail clippings.
Bless them for thinking that's going to still keep the woman. That's going to get a real selective lady, that is. I think
it is. Well, here's a man's point of view from one of these. So I was finished with a date when she said she needed a wee when we walked out from the bar. I thought, okay. She walked over to the alleyway, pulled down her jeans, and then took a shit behind the bin in front of me. She then searched in the bin to find a newspaper to wipe her ass with. It was a shame because I was totally infatuated with her after working with her for 6 months. Couldn't believe I was on the date with her, but in 30 seconds, she ruined everything. He'd been working on this for 6 months, thinking she is so hot. Oh my God, she's finally said yes to this date, and she just thinks, I'll just take a shit down the alleyway and wipe my ass with a newspaper.
Do you think she did shit? Because she obviously needed paper. I reckon she did a wee. She's not going to say I need a shit. She's not going to shit.
Maybe it came out accidentally.
Who does that? I remember being in San Francisco and I just walked past the car and there's this lady bent over doing her shit. What the hell? But that's San Francisco.
Oh my. Bloody hell.
Yeah, that was weird. That was weird.
Here's a good one, Gav, for a first date. This is a woman saying this. He took me to a strip club and he said, Do you like to do what? So this is the first date.
Yeah,
do you like to party? I've got loads of cocaine.
Oh, you like to party? That could mean anything, couldn't it?
Yeah, but he meant cocaine because he'd taken her to a strip club to do cocaine. So this is the first date. She then said to him, to try and make conversation, do you have a big family? And he said, well, what do you mean by that? And she said, well, I mean like cousins, lots of cousins. And he said, what do you mean siblings? What siblings? What are cousins? What does that mean?
I think he's probably
he didn't
just
know what the word siblings or cousins meant.
No, I think she's got out of context. I reckon he's confused, saying, why are you asking me about my family? There's vagina up there on the show and there's loads of cocaine in our noses. Let's have a party.
I don't understand
why this dude... I like the fact that he's being... this is what I'm like. This is me as a human being. These are my vices. If you like it as well, we can be party friends.
He then said to me, if I gave you $100, would you take a stack of dollar notes and make it rain on that stripper over there? He kept asking me for about 30 minutes and I said, I want to go home. He said, all right, well, can I come home with you for sex? I said, no. And he said, oh, for fuck's sake, what's the point? Made a scene and stormed out of the strip club, leaving me in there.
That is incredible. That goes down in one of the worst dates in history.
It's interesting, that, isn't it?
That is just in a craziness. That is craziness.
I met a guy online, not me, this woman. and we went for dinner. During dinner, he was eating ribs, chewing with his mouth open, and wiping the barbecue sauce from his hands onto his white tank top. He then tried to feed me ribs by hand.
White tank top for a start, come on.
The only two things he talked were how much he went to the gym and his mum. He then said, hang on a minute, I'll FaceTime my mum and you can meet her. And he did. Gav's mouth now currently, listeners, is wide open.
Wow, I've chatted to Sarah about it before. Like, she's like, I can never go out if someone goes to the gym all the time because all they do is talk about the gym. And I suppose that is the case of some people who just do the gym all the time and like their body and stuff. But yeah, and your mum, actually, because I'm talking about my mum, you can meet her if you like.
FaceTime.
Yeah, all right.
That's my date.
Does he think like that? Because obviously you're into me so much, we're probably getting married. So he may as well meet my mum now.
Here's another fart-related one. This is a guy this time. I was out with a girl who kept farting the entire time we were playing mini-golf. They weren't smelly, just really loud. I didn't really know what it was first. I noticed that every time she was knocking the cane, her putter on the ground like a cane, I realised she was using it to tap as she was farting at the same time to try and cover up the noise. So she was like banging it down and farting at the same time to try and disguise it. After a while, I realised what it was. I walked away. I went home.
I was with a lady once. It was a very late after the pubs. It was like a Friday night. We were at the skate park. I won't say what we were doing. We were hanging out a little bit, and at one point she farted, and it smelled. She did it, and it's real quiet. But I knew she had farted, and I was like, okay, I'm not gonna. I don't want to embarrass her, and I don't want to try and ruin my chances here. So I'll just play it cool and stuff. And so I just looked up at the air because I was going, "Oh my god, that smells so fucking bad! It smells so bad." But I didn't know what to do, so I just looked up like I was in deep concentration. "What are you thinking about?" I said, "The stars."
The stars.
And it's all right though. I still, you know, won't go into any more detail. But still, the stars. That was just like, oh my god.
I'm going to use that one, I think, if someone ever catches me out. Dan, what were you thinking? Oh, just the stars. I was just thinking about the stars, actually.
Well, make sure it's night time.
Because you sound really romantic, don't you, as well?
Well, actually, I think I kind of got away with it all right. The stars, just looking at the universe and stuff, and just some bollocks. Nowadays, I like the stars, you know.
Here's another honest one. You like the honest ones. I had a date with a girl who told me, "I must let you know this, that I am engaged, but I'm not 100% sure if he's the right one, so I am going to go on a few dates first to see if there's anybody else out there better. If not, I'll marry him."
Wow.
Yeah. Honest again. Like, you like the honest ones.
So I'm going to go out with this guy. If he's right, marry. Yeah.
Okay. That's good, isn't it?
I don't know if that marriage is going to last.
I had a date with a guy who worked at a shoe shop, and all he did was talk about shoes. He spent about an hour trying to guess what size feet I had.
Amazing. Bringing his work into to his life. 7?
What?
No.
Why?
8? No. 7.5? No. Oh my god, just give it up. Don't talk about shoe sizes. Went on a date last night, could not guess her shoe size. Ridiculous. I'm really good at guessing shoe size as well.
There's one here about a girl who went on a date with a guy who spent the first hour talking about how much he likes to go down on women's bottoms. Within the first hour.
How much he likes a rim job.
Yeah. And then he said to her, "I think this could really work if you lose some weight."
Oh my god. Is he saying this while looking at a bum? How do you even do that? Is it straight away into that, or do you bring the conversation into, "When I start to get down with a lady, I like to touch the breasts and kiss the neck." And then I slowly...
You've been on the date 1 hour.
How does he get to there that so quickly? Love putting my tongue up a woman's arse.
Maybe talk about where you were born, or your first job, or your hobbies. Don't go straight for that.
Lollipops. Say you like licking lollipops. Don't go straight for bum holes. Okay.
I've got a really good true story about a friend of mine. No one you would have ever met. A guy from a long time ago who...
Oh, yeah.
He...
It's probably
met,
you.
He pulled a girl. It wasn't me. Pulled a girl to brought her home for, you know, for one night stand, and they were really getting down to it, and she was on top. She turned around, so he thought, "Oh, here we go, reverse cowgirl, excellent," and she did a poo on his chest.
Amazing. So this is him just taking a lady home just for just straight sex, really. It's a little bit.
He told us about it about 2 days later, and we were all felt really sorry for him. We were like, who does that? You kind of have to ask whether that's okay. It's not just a normal.
It's a bit of a build up to it. At least the second date. And if the first date, yeah, the sex is that good, you know, that something like that's going to go that way. Second date, okay, maybe go that way. If you're into it, obviously. But wow.
He said,
It's awkward. What happened then afterwards?
He said he threw her off him and she fell onto the floor, started crying. And then he was faced with a crying woman on the floor and a poo on his chest. I said, well, what did you do? He said, I sort of flicked my chest and flicked it off onto the floor and told her to fuck off. And she said, she was really drunk. She's crying and just got a taxi home.
Wow.
I think he said that she said something like, sorry, I thought you'd be into it, or something like that. But I said to him, so
how
what
do
about
you gauge
you?
That?
Yeah, I said, so she thinks, one look at you like having a shit on your chest.
Yeah, that's not good. I've never looked at someone and thought that either, though.
I'd like to take a poo on you. I've never thought that.
No. And don't say that to me again.
I'm sorry. I wouldn't like to take a poo on you. I'd wee on you.
No.
That is my list of bad dates.
You've ruined it by saying urinate on me at the end there. You totally ruined that.
I'm sure there's some worse first dates out there, like people that have gone on a date with a serial killer and been eaten and we don't know about it.
Yeah, probably. Yeah. Right now, and they're in the car listening to this podcast.
And they're looking at them going, hang on a minute.
Shit. If you are listening to this and it's in the car, ladies and gentlemen, this is a public service announcement. Be warned, your date may be a killer of the axe variety or knife variety or cannibal and eat you up and serve you to the neighbours at a barbecue.
Bill Murray liked that story, didn't he? Yeah, baby!
Bill.
Yeah, all right, Bill.
Get us out of here.
That's all the time we've got for this week on World of Strange. Next week, though, Kimmy Ira. Hairless pets. Weird.
And we're back again, ladies and gents. Non-gendered people, too. I hope you've enjoyed yourselves. And got sexy with us. I imagine that last bit started to pull the sexiness away. They're shitting on
I hope you've enjoyed us as well as yourself and everything that we've done.
I hope you enjoyed yourself lovely while love you listen episode. To us.
Oh God, not that. That's not what I meant. But if you do,
that Gavin Dan,
I love it when they talk about shitting. So that was a fun episode. I always love our Valentine's episodes. We've done some great ones over the years. It's been fun. That was
next year. I do think we should do The Loved Ones. I think that should probably be a movie we should cover, which you've not seen. It's not as good as Double Date, but it's about a date. Something happens. It's interesting.
I've been thinking about, there's a couple of Hammer horrors that we could do that relate to sort of like vampire lovers and that kind of stuff, so maybe we could do something like that.
I've just found out, speaking of some Hammer people, I'm going to be at a convention this year. It's finally going ahead because COVID hit a couple of years ago. Deadbolt Films, I'm going to do like a low to no budget filmmaking workshop for 2 days, and there's going to be some Hammer actresses there. Carolyn Munro and some others are going to be there. They'll get to meet them. And do you know, I told you, didn't I, who I'm meeting there? The dude from Nightmare on Elm Street 2. Well, I'm not meeting him there.
The guy from...
He's going to be there, so I'll try and say hello.
The main guy from Nightmare on Elm Street 2, who does the amazing dance.
The red-headed girlfriend, isn't it? She's there too.
Sweet. I love that
but
film.
Close to the time, I will give dates and more information. So if anybody wants to go along, it's a horror convention for 2 days in Southampton, bottom of England. And it should be quite good.
We'll put it on the Facebook page as well.
Yeah, yeah.
And we'll talk about it on here, on this very show.
And it'd be a bit weird hosting a panel. It's a bit weird. I expect I'll have nobody in the audience except Sarah.
I'll be there.
Excuse me! Yeah. All right. If you got some Hammer movies, that'd be cool.
We'll have a think about it.
So got 365, haven't we?
Talking about what's coming up next.
Yeah.
episode 119, our next episode, we are going to be doing... We're going to be looking at two mighty erections.
Builder of mighty erections.
We are going to be covering two films that involve giant buildings being scaled.
Not horror.
One of them, not horror, but action, violence, cult. Science fiction-y, cult. One of them is The Raid, which we talked about before. Welsh director.
Incredible. Welsh director, Indonesian film, low.
Incredible. Just incredible stuff. And yeah, we thought, you know, it'd be fun to talk about that. And also, we also want to talk about it, pair it up with this other movie, which we're both huge fans of.
In the same vein. They're both in the same vein, really.
Same vein. Comic book, though, this one more. And that's Dread. And I know there's a lot of fans of Dread out there. You know, there's the Judge Dredd movie with Stallone that came out.
Yeah, we'll have to get into it. You have to have a look at the YouTube footage of the director. He's in crow makeup talking about why he couldn't make another Dread movie and just like where it all got fucked up. Have a look at that before we talk about it, so we can discuss like the future of that or no future of that, really. Because it should have had a sequel, quite obviously, but yeah, the same happened. But yeah, check it out.
So we're going to be discussing a bunch of Indonesian police officers kicking ass all the way at the top of a building.
Stuck in a building, they got to get out.
Yeah. And Carl Urban shooting people
stuck in a building, slow motion. And he's got to get out. And they came out at the same time as well. It was one of those things where the end of the world and the world's end, you know, those.
Yeah.
Just have these movies that just come out at the same time, and it's really funny, actually. These two did. And Dredd kind of got lost behind, funny enough, the Indonesian one. That was more of the focus point, I remember, at the time.
But I think Dredd's picked up a cult following. People love it, and they want a sequel. But
no, there's
Carl
reason.
Urban said he'd love to do one, but...
No, find this video. I watched it once, but the director, I don't know if it's still out in line, because I don't think he's going to be keeping many people happy from the stuff he's saying. As far as I can remember, I don't remember it exactly. Yeah,
we'll find it.
Yeah,
but that's our next episode. After that, it'll be time for Easter, so we'll be getting to some leprechaun action. But we'll cover that properly, but you know, as and when. Thank you for sticking with us, guys. We know we're slowed down our output, but we're still, you know, we're still ticking along, dropping one a month. And for our I'll come on to our Patreon supporters properly in a moment, but if you are a Patreon supporter, you will actually be getting the main episodes a little bit early as well, just almost a week early if you're a Patreon supporter, and then they'll drop into the main feed, and you're also going to be getting bonus content as well as old episodes. Our back catalogue is slowly being released every Freaky Friday, so that's some of the incentive there to become a patron.
And we're trying to just put up some little bits and bobs from us when we can do so also.
Indeed. Well, do a bit of admin and then we'll say our goodbyes. So as always, and as we have been for the last 8 years, we are the podcast on Haunted Hill. We are a proud member of Legion Podcast Network. Go to legionpodcast.com to find out more about all of the shows in the network, not just us. There are many fantastic, great shows. You can find out more about Legion on Facebook. And you can find out more about us on Facebook. Just go for the podcast on Haunted Hill. We are really active on there. We've got lots of people chatting, sharing, liking, loving, and just generally being a nice little family, isn't it, Gab? Your family.
Indeed.
Yeah. If you want to email us directly, privately, away from prying eyes, just go to the podcast on Haunted Hill at outlook.com. You can send me a message, you can request things, ask questions, you could do that on Facebook, you could just message us on Facebook Messenger. We're pretty open, guys. We're available on all podcast platforms, wherever you're listening to this, Spotify, YouTube, all the other ones. We'd love a review or a rating. If you're on I believe Spotify now, you can rate, so you can do all this stuff. It'd be really helps the algorithms, is a word I love to say. But also, we'd love to hear feedback. You know, what are we doing right? What are we doing wrong? We've been going a long time now, and we haven't had an awful lot of feedback and reviews. We've got a lot of people who listen, but, you know, it'd be nice to hear what you think of us. We're on Twitter, at Haunted Podcast. We're on Instagram, the podcast on Haunted Hill Insta. And Deadbolt Films, as we mentioned just now, is our production company. We have comics, we have a couple of podcasts, we have short films, we have feature-length films, and other bits and bobs coming out. Have we still got a game? Have we still got a game coming out?
Board game?
Thing. Yeah.
I was doing something with someone who was thinking of designing things, and we haven't really done anything, so no, that's not really a thing now.
We haven't got a game. But for more on Deadbolt Films, go to deadboltfilms.com, go to YouTube, type in Deadbolt Films, that's our channel.
I know Tom was thinking of something around the comic that he produces through Deadbolt. I don't know. If you're listening, Tom, tell us. I should know.
Also, Deadbolt Films is on Instagram. Just go for Deadbolt Films and Twitter at Deadbolt Films. And finally, thank you firstly to everyone who listens, and thank you to everybody within Legion Network, Bo, and everybody who makes it possible for us to get into your ears. Obviously, Gav, you're the main one that does that because you produce the show.
And Bo also, he's the one that
secures the
other stuff.
Yeah, he sorts everything out.
Accessible.
But a special thank you.
Yes, and I do that. I don't do much, to be honest. I don't really do that much. Record, I'm the hub of the recording. I'm the main recorder. I have the mic here, unless we're in together and we both have a mic, but we're not, haven't been for a long time. And editing, I don't really have to do that much. I don't really chop our stuff up. It's normally just little chunks put together, and all the sound levels, all the fines, I never change anything. It's quite simple, actually.
When you've done something for 8 years, we don't generally need to do much, do we?
Change it.
Kind of got this down,
really. No, there's no point. We've got a sound. I'm kind of happy with the sound. I did used to get really fussy with it, and sometimes the sound's been awful and it's really bugged me, but the sound we have now is I'm happy with this, so it's going to continue.
Finally, a special big thank yous to our Patreon supporters, as always.
Thank you.
You guys are wonderful. We really appreciate your support.
Absolutely.
Financially, but also just being a Patreon supporter is amazing. You obviously get all those freebie things I talked about earlier, t-shirt when you join. And if you guys who aren't a Patreon supporter want to become one, just go to Patreon, type in the podcast on Haunted Hill. You can also become a Legion patron as well and support the entire network. There's other bits and bobs available on there, exclusive content. I want to thank, by name as always, our patrons. So thank you very much to Don Collier, Matthew Godley, Jamie Jenkins, Kevin S. Fife, Sarah Kay, Rachel, RJ McCready, Lex Boo, and that's everybody.
Thank you so much.
Sorry about
us
singing.
I hope you're making love while you listen to us.
Okay, so it's a good night from a badass MMA sexy woman with a syringe in a nightclub who wants to stab you.
It's good. Good night from a drunken suicidal Tom Atkins.
It's a good night from Tom Atkins' moustache.
Yeah, and a good night from his moustache.
It's a good night from slugs being fired out of my mouth into a cat.
Yes, and it's good night from me.
It's a good night from me. We'll be back soon with some epic kung fu martial arts
action stuff we're talking about. Yeah, so a little bit different, but yeah, interesting all the same, I hope, and I imagine the conversations will be quite fun too.
Indeed. Well, take care, everybody. Stay safe. COVID restrictions are lifting in England soon, so maybe we might be seeing some normality. Obviously, that doesn't mean COVID's vanished. I'm not thick, but I do know that that means we can start getting back to a bit of normality, perhaps. So, yay! Whoop, whoop.
Yeah, that's quite strange because it did that. I have been quite lenient with it now anyway. I haven't really been wearing masks and things, and I've been just kind of going about myself a bit. But yes, for some things have been restricted for some people, haven't they? So cool, good. Okay, go back to slightly normal. Weird.
I know. So it's been 2 years.
It's been 2 years. They said it'd be probably about 2 years as well. I know it hasn't gone, I'm not saying it's gone. It's never gonna go, I don't think, really. But anyway. Yeah. Right.
There we go. Well,
end off.
Goodbye, everybody.
Goodbye. Make love to yourself, and, make love to your partners, make love to things if they let you.
And if you can't make love to yourself,
don't know. What's that?
What's the point?
What's the point?
I don't know what's going on.
I don't know
what's going on.
Bye
bye, everyone.
You know, there's going to be someone out there who maybe can't make love to themselves, Dan. You're alienating them.
I'm so sorry about that. If you can't make love to yourself, then I'll come and do that for you. Just message me and I'll be there.
Dan will do that. And on that note, Good night.
Good night.
Thank you for listening to the podcast on Haunted Hill. We will be back again real soon.